We've structured the show such that we'll be touring through the solar system one planet at a time, breaking down the most prominent features of each planet. So that's going to be really exciting. Art, VFX, tools, shaders, we'll be talking about all of it and looking at it in the Unity editor. So without further ado, let's look at the trailer for the newly released DLC for Outer Wilds, Echoes of the Eye. Back to that trailer. Hello, welcome, John and Wesley. It's such a pleasure to have you with us live. Could you just introduce yourselves to everybody?
Yeah, I'm Wesley Martin. I'm the art director at Mobius. Before working at Mobius, I worked briefly at Microsoft on the HoloLens and made another indie game called Elsinore. But I've been at Mobius for 5.5 years. So right at the beginning of when we started on Outer Wilds to the present.
Hey, I'm John Oppenheimer. I'm a 3D environment and VFX artist on the Outer Wilds team. I've worked here for about 1.5 years, and before that, I graduated at Laguna College of Art and Design. Some of my favorite games are Destiny 2, For Honor, and the Dark Souls series.
Okay, nice. Okay, thank you so much for joining us. Before we dive into like talking about the art and your art direction philosophy, Wes, I believe you have a spoiler warning for us.
Yes. So if you've played Outer Wilds, you know that it is a knowledge-based puzzle game where all of the narrative clues basically is how you play the game. So if you haven't played Outer Wilds and you watch this stream, it will literally ruin the narrative and gameplay of the entire game. We will have a separate section to talk about Echoes of the Eye, so you don't have to worry about spoilers for that right away. I will give you another spoiler warning before that.
Yeah, and I want as many of you as possible to watch the stream, but really, this game, masterpiece. So please, if you want to play it, definitely play the game first, and then you can watch this as a VOD on Unity's YouTube channel. We'll be releasing it in about a week or two, so you won't be missing this. Yeah, let's jump right in. Wesley, maybe you can give us a little history about like the game, the origins of the game, and the origins of the team, the original game, and then we can dive into the DLC later.
Yeah, so Outer Wilds started out as Alex Beecham's thesis project at USC. And at the time, he also worked on it with Alain Renaud, who's our other designer on the team and creative lead, along with Alex. So those two from the original team are still working on it. And Alex continued to develop it for a while after his thesis was done, and he eventually entered it into the Indie Games Festival in 2015, where it won the Grand Prize and Excellence in Design Awards. So at the time, Alex was working with Loan at Mobius, which had started up as sort of like a mobile game studio doing creative experiments. And they decided, hey, let's just make Outer Wilds our next project. Yeah. So right after that, they hired myself, several of our programmers, and we sort of built up a 3D art team with the goal of basically taking the alpha build that won IGF and polishing it up, releasing it in about a year. And 5 years later, we released the game. So there was a bit of a turnaround. After about 6 months of development, we were contacted by Annapurna, who at that point hadn't released any games under their publishing label, so it was kind of a new thing at the time. And they said, hey, you know, we know you're working on this crowdfunded thing, and we would really like to see it like taken to the next level. So they came to us and said, you know, let's redefine the art style, let's polish up the game, like, let's do this super, super high quality. And so we were super excited by that. And we sort of went radio silent for about 2 years. And then when we unveiled Outer Wilds is as you know it today. So we released in 2019 and immediately started work on a quick DLC that was going to be a Halloween themed release of that same year that the game came out. And it sort of turned into a second game. So that was, we now call it an expansion because it's about half again the base game. And that just released last month. So I guess 2 months ago now that it's November. So we're very excited to have it out there. So that's the history of the game. I'll do sorry, just a quick... Oh, go ahead.
Oh, sorry, I was muted. I was saying congratulations on that release. I guess it's the first time I hear this, but there was always that intention of having it have more of a spooky vibe to the DLC. Like,
yeah, it was release. It was basically like, you know, when the game shipped and we saw the reactions to the game and a lot of people were like, you know, I'm terrified of oceans or tornadoes or black holes. We were like, oh, there's like clearly like a horror element that a lot of people enjoy about the game. And we really wanted to try making something more on the spooky side.
Yeah, absolutely. For me, that was Dark Bramble. That was just terrifying every time I had to explore that part of the... I'd always leave that to later. You know, I was like, yeah, I'll go to Dark Bramble later. I don't need to go there. And so you've told us a little bit about the history of Outer Wilds, Echoes of the Eye, and can we dive maybe into the visual inspirations for the main game? So we'll get to talking about Echoes of the Eye, the DLC, later at the end of the show. So if you haven't played Echoes of the Eye, but you still want to watch this stream and you've played the base game, you can watch. We'll have a second spoiler warning towards the end where we'll start talking about Echoes of the Eye. So it's Echoes of the Eye spoiler free for now. We'll let you know when you need to jump off. Yeah. So yeah, maybe you can tell us a bit about the visual inspirations for the base game.
Yeah. So the sort of the original art direction, even back in the alpha before I worked on the project, the catchphrase that the team liked to use was camping in space. So that was sort of like the prompt that was given to me when I joined the team as the new art director. And, you know, we took that theme and doubled down on it and tried to expand on it. And it's really been sort of our catch-all term for the aesthetic for the entire time. So what camping in space means is it's sort of a hybrid of this sort of rustic, backwoods, naturalistic environment that you'd find, like, you know, hiking around, backpacking in a national park in the US. And then we mix that with sort of 60s, 70s era NASA. So like, you know, more Apollo 13 as opposed to more modern sci-fi. And so by combining those two things, we sort of create the like Hearthian aesthetic, and a lot of like the planets that you explore, we wanted them to feel like you're backpacking around a national park. And then the Nomai are sort of the other side of camping, where, you know, you're out hiking and you find some mysterious ruin in the woods, or, you know, something like Mesa Verde out in the cliffs, and you're like, oh, what, you know, who used to live there? What did they do? And so that's sort of where the archaeology element of discovering the Nomai comes from.
I find the camping in space is such a great prompt, because it also led to what I experienced as two different scopes to the game. Like, there was this, you know, the larger scope of this, you know, the grand, like the grandness of space and all of that. But then there's also these, like, the intimacy of sitting next to a campfire. There are these smaller intimate moments where, you know, maybe you're in a ruin reading like some lore, like these smaller, more intimate moments. But then there's also moments where you're just like flying past the sun and it's, you know, it's about the supernova and it's like quite epic. And I think it's kind of led to that as well.
Yeah, actually, the original alpha build of the game, when it was a thesis project, it sort of began as a series of small prototypes. And one of those prototypes was sitting on a small planet, roasting a marshmallow while you watch a supernova. And that was definitely like the tonal spark for pretty much the whole game.
Yeah, it's contrast there.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, maybe, so we talked about the visual inspirations. You dive into the art direction philosophy, you know, as the art director for the game. What kind of like guided you, and what were important things you felt you had to tackle?
Yeah. So before I even joined the team, I was able to play the alpha build of the game. So, you know, it was like the night before my interview, and I was like, oh, what's this game that won IGF? And I started playing it, and then it was 4 a.m. and I was trying to get to the middle of Dark Bramble. So I was immediately hooked. And
yeah,
when I started on the team, I wanted to basically, like, the goal for the art was not to mess it up. Because, you know, a lot of teams out there, it's like there's friction between the different disciplines on the team where art wants to do one thing, design wants to do another, and they have to compromise. Mm. And there's definitely some of that on our team, but my goal as an art director is to basically provide support. So, you know, the entire art style was defined around how can we realize Outer Wilds and use the art not to, like, just make it look pretty, but also to enhance the design. So there's sort of two main, like, pillars as far as making art that lead to that. The first is that we have, like, extremely specific level design. And so we want all of the art to support that level design. And the way that we do that is by having sort of background assets and focal assets. Mm-hmm. And this is something that you see in a lot of games, but we really double down on it. Where, you know, if you're looking at Timber Hearth, you're going to see, like, you know, some plants and some rocks. And, you know, here on Giant's Deep, it's just a bunch of water. And we really didn't want the art to steal the show from the things that you're supposed to go to, because Outer Wilds is a game about following clues. So we intentionally made everything else sort of more muted colors and less detail, so that the clues like Nomai Ruins and Hearthian Recorders and things like that, they really stand out in this sort of desolate environment. So, you know, we ended up putting more lights on things than we wanted to, but, you know, it's all about, like, making sure that when a player sees a scene, they know exactly where they should be going. Right. And that really helps to communicate to the player what they should be doing.
So you had to avoid making everything look very interesting as an art director. Don't make things look too good.
You know, you play a lot of open world games and it's like, oh, there's some really cool set piece off in the distance and you want to go there because it looks cool. And then you get there and it's just like a nice 3D model. And you're like, what? There's nothing here.
Right.
And so, you know, with Outer Wilds, anything that looks cool is actually something you can go to and investigate. And, you know, our goal as the developers is to make sure that if you have a question as a player, that you can find an answer somewhere in the game. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I think the size of the planets, nothing ever feels too barren or anything like that. There's enough focal points on each planet that it still feels very populated.
Yeah, exactly. And sort of the other pillar of making art for Outer Wilds is performance, which is also something that every game has to deal with, right? Making the game run. But Outer Wilds is a bit unique in that it's like, in addition to being this narrative exploration game, it's also a physics simulation. So the planets are these actual physics objects that move around in orbit. They're not like on an animation track or something. They're actually like given a force at the beginning. And there's also a lot of weird quirks about the game, like you can attach your scout to something and then fly your ship somewhere else. And so we need to be able to render these two different environments simultaneously without, like, you know, some sort of streaming system. And we do use stuff like some basic streaming and LODs and stuff like that. But a lot of the art style was designed to basically enable the game to run at, you know, doing all this physics stuff and making the art in such a way where we could do the cooler things as far as gameplay and, you know, the visual quality, so to speak, might take the backseat. So, you know, building on spheres and making all these things so that you can actually, like, go up and look at them close. You know, there's no background assets, essentially. So that was sort of the other pillar that drove the art direction of Outer Wilds.
I'd like to dwell on that a little bit. You know, unlike other games, this game is very true to reality in that the levels are actually, like, the world is actually spherical, right? It's not, most games are just, like, the world is flat and then you're not really exploring that far. But here you can go around the entire planet. And there's always a horizon. There's always a horizon line when you're on a planet, right? And so, could you talk maybe a bit more about that? How you have to think about building an environment when it's spherical and not flat? What are the differences there?
The biggest difference is that spherical environments aren't supported by video game development tools. So, you know, programs like Maya and Unity don't have, you know, polar coordinates or tools that snap things to spheres. That's just not something that anybody does. So why would you have tools to support it? And so a lot of the challenge of making Outer Wilds was just, you know, developing the tools ourselves so that we could do things on spheres. And there's a lot of sort of parts of game engines that people take for granted where it's like, oh, I'm going to turn on fog and now there's fog in the scene. But for Outer Wilds, if you turn on fog, then there's fog in space. And so we had to create, you know, these spherical fog volumes, and we'll go in depth, like, on each planet to, like, the specific things that we had to tackle. But yeah, it was definitely like a huge challenge to just build things on spheres.
Yeah, I think that's a perfect segue into talking about the first planet, Timber Hearth, right? And so we can talk about some of those gravity placement tools, that, like some of the tools you made to make placement on a sphere easier, and what it's like making a curved terrain. So maybe I think we'll be jumping to John's screen share. And John, maybe do you want to jump into the editor for us?
Yeah, sounds good.
In case you were, that wasn't B-roll footage. That was John playing the game the entire time, by the way.
Edit the loop right on time.
Professional game. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So we're looking in editor at Timber Hearth right now.
Yeah. So here we are on Timber Hearth. As you'll see, there's no trickery. The game is really built on spheres. We don't build things flat and then bend it when we build or anything. It's just, it's always on spheres. And that means, you know, sometimes you have trouble pointing the camera in the right direction. You know, it's harder to create assets, but we have a lot of tools that we use to support that methodology. So the first thing I'll show as an example is the Addle Rock. So over here, just as an example of building a game on spheres, you'll notice that we have a spiral ramp. And when you walk down the spiral ramp, it feels pretty flat. It's like a linear incline. But the thing you'll notice when you look at it from another angle is that it's tilted outward, and the curvature gets more intense the closer you go towards the center of the sphere. And the reason for that is because, you know, if you're higher up on a sphere, the radius is larger. And if you're lower down, the radius is smaller. What that means is if you're creating something like an incline, you always have to be aware of how the curvature changes to make it feel right for the player. The other thing is, you know, this has to be tilted outward because it's coming in from the radius of the sphere. And so you always have to worry about where the player is standing relative to gravity and make sure that they're flush with the ground and, you know, standing straight up, which can be really challenging. Because like Wesley said, a lot of 3D programs don't, or well, no 3D programs really support building games on spheres. They're all, you know, about grids and making things on flat surfaces. So we have to use a lot of like custom scripts and custom tools in Unity, which we're going to talk about a lot, to get that to work. Mm-hmm. So instead of something like a height map that, you know, like Unity or Unreal might do for like a terrain painter, we generally model our terrain. The designers do a gray box, and then we will go into Maya. We'll increase the subdivisions a bit so it, you know, has a high enough poly count. And then we bring it into ZBrush. We deform it based on, you know, the art needs and like the style of our rocks and stuff. And then we bring it back in to Unity. And, you know, we check it out, we play test it, and we iterate from there. So that's the Addle Rock. But now I want to show you one of our tools that is super useful for placing props. Because one of the toughest things about making a game on curved surfaces is having things actually be flat to the ground. So as an example here, let's say that you have a tree and you want the tree to face straight up from the surface. Well, you can rotate it in one axis, you can move the camera, you can rotate it in another, but it's pretty cumbersome. And it's dependent on your camera facing, right? So you can get it right in one or two, but then the instant you look somewhere else, you're like, oh shoot, it's off. So we have this tool that one of our engineers made that lives in the transform component, where we can stick things to any surface by holding S, so like that. And we can also align things to the surface by holding A, or align them to gravity. And what that means is instead of trying to manually line something up, we can go a little closer like this, and you'll see it curving around the surface of the planet. And that ends up being really useful because it's not only a more accurate result than trying to line it up on your own, but it's faster too. You don't have to, you know, do camera trickery and all this wiggling. Another cool thing that it can do is we can choose the axis that it aligns on. So if for whatever reason you have to build things on an inverted surface, which we would definitely never do, you can do this here. So there are a bunch of useful tools there to make placing props and, you know, building up the level a lot easier.
Yeah, I can't imagine you having to like place each and every single one of these props just manually. It would just make things too cumbersome, right? And
yeah,
really just like, not an enjoyable process.
Yeah, and you know, something like Timber Hearth, where you have a bunch of trees lined up in, you know, a forest or something, it's really clear when the alignment is off, because like, you know, one of the trees might be like canted at an angle, and then it just breaks, you know, the immersion and everything. So it helps to have like an exact tool to get the alignment right.
And so so we have the curved terrain, the gravity placement tool, but there's also, I think we're going to jump to Wesley's screen share to talk about the detail patches, another tool.
So the detail patches is sort of a more advanced tool based on the same idea as the transform tool that we have. And detail patches are what we use for basically like foliage and really, really small props. So I'll just grab the scene and bake our details. So you can see there's no plants right now in the scene. And we have this tool that basically converts them all into meshes, but I'll unconvert one so you can see how it works. This tool is a lifesaver. It literally made the game possible. We couldn't have made the art for the game without this. So you can see now, this is one of our detail patches. I'll grab this one. So we have a bunch of them in here. And I will unbake the detail patch so that we can edit it.
So this generates a bunch of like instances of little like plant details, and I guess it's different for each planet.
Yes, exactly. So there's a few things about this, and I'll kind of run through it quickly. But we have detail palettes, which are basically these assets that we create, where we determine, you know, how many meshes go into the detail palette, and we can determine the density. So like this mesh, for example, you can see down there, it's these little red flowers. We can determine what material it should use, if we want to randomize rotation scale or color, what it should align to, whether it's gravity or the surface that it snapped to. And then the density value here changes the ratio of it when we randomize. Nice. And so the random is basically a tool on the detail patch itself, where we can basically just, you know, scatter these about, which is really handy for just like quickly getting some variety. And you can change the count here. So, you know, if we want to be more dense, can add more of them, can also change the shape. And the really nice thing about these is that they're basically volumes and they snap to whatever's underneath them. So if you want plants all over this stump, you can just like drag it there and they'll go. And you're like, you know, that one looks kind of awkward. We have an edit mode, so you can go in and take this one and manually move it somewhere else.
Oh, nice. So you can customize those inspector variables before generating and after generating. You have two options. So
yeah, it's completely, it's reversible entirely. So, you know, once we have this detail patch, you can save it out as a template, load in templates. If I just click bake detail again, that turns it back into a mesh. And we have an automated script that runs whenever we make a build that just, you know, goes through the entire game and bakes all these out. So then they just turn into geometry.
It just optimizes.
Exactly. So that, I like to tell an anecdote about how in the first year of development where, you know, we didn't have the support of Annapurna yet, I went through and populated the old version of the village with ferns, because it was like, oh, we want plants everywhere. And it took me about 2 weeks of just, you know, doing what John showed, of going in and like, you know, duplicating each fern, scaling it a little bit, rotating it around. And when we got the detail patch tool in later, I did the same amount of work in about an afternoon. I created the detail palettes, set up the detail patches, duplicated them around the village. And, you know, it was 10 times as many plants, and it took me an afternoon instead of 2 weeks. So
I'm very interested in how you got to the point where you're like, okay, this is a tool we need to make. Was that a specific request of you, from you as the art director? Or like, how do you come to the conclusion of what tools you should build and what tools you should, like, what things should be done manually and what should be built as a tool?
Yeah, it's a good question. We, because of the way our development worked, where we had the alpha build and then we worked on it for a while and then we like sort of rebooted the art, we had a lot of things in mind in terms of like, this is a tool that we really should make because we spent a lot of time doing this, and it's the kind of thing you could automate a lot with a clever script. And so when we were rebooting our art style, we took the time to sit down and be like, okay, you know, what are the top priority tools that we want to save us time? And this was at the top of the list, because a lot of games sort of get around this by having, you know, height maps, and you get data from the height map, and then you use that to propagate plants throughout the game. There's some cool like videos on Horizon Zero Dawn that show that kind of stuff. But again, because we're working on spheres, we can't use height maps because they're all like square projection based things. So this was essentially our workaround so that we could arbitrarily put plants on, you know, any angle in Unity without having to do a lot of manual rotations.
And this automatically snaps to the terrain, so it doesn't matter that the terrain is spherical?
Correct. It snaps to the terrain. You can also just set it to snap to like any collider. So that's how I was able to like put the plants on top of the stump. But you can choose a specific mesh as well, and we often will like set it to snap to the terrain specifically, because, you know, we don't want plants growing on top of random stuff.
Yeah. Don't plant on the trees, that would look
exactly
climbing all the way to the top.
And the other big benefit to this tool is sort of the first pillar of art that I mentioned, which is that level design is huge. So you know, we use plants all over the game to guide the eye. So, you know, we try not to have plants in the middle of the road like this. You can see they're all like out of the way, so it very clearly like emphasizes the pathway that you're supposed to take.
Yeah, and it's subtle enough that like you can kind of just ignore it. At the same time, it can fall into the background, and that also feeds into your first point, right? With like the
focus. Exactly.
Yeah. That's great. We're getting a lot. We've gotten so many questions just about like before the stream and during the stream, just about like how you achieved atmosphere and fog and all of these different things. And I think, let's say, the next thing you're going to jump into is the atmosphere and the spherical fog system. And so it's like it's not just the planets that are built on spheres, but a lot of your systems are actually also built on spheres, right?
Exactly.
Quite unique to this game. So I'd love for you to dive into that.
Yeah, definitely. So as I mentioned, there's sort of a lot of things you take for granted about game engines. You know, if you've worked in Unity or Unreal, it's just like, okay, here's the box that you learn how to click that turns on fog. And we can't do that because spheres. So we actually have custom solutions for a lot of basic things. So we have our fog spheres here, and this basically we have a system that bakes out a 3D texture, and the 3D texture determines density by height, as well as, you know, the depth of the planet here. And so it's basically a shader that goes on a sphere, and you know, we have like an LOD version when you're far away. And then it also uses a color ramp to determine there's two axes here. One is depth and one is like the angle of the light. So basically, you know, in daytime, the fog is this bright blue. And let's see if I can make this bigger. Oh, not very well. In daytime, it's this bright blue, and at nighttime, it's darker and less dense. And so that was a huge thing for us, because we really wanted to sell the feeling that you're on these tiny spheres flying around in space, and atmosphere is a great way to do that. But there's more to it than just the fog spheres. We also have this fancy atmosphere shader. So if I turn off, I can turn off the wireframe here. So if I turn off the fog, you can see that it, you know, the fog tints the surface, but the part that tints space is actually different. And this is a very fancy shader that our tech artist slash engineer extraordinaire Logan wrote. And this is actually, you'll see similar atmosphere shaders in, you know, like flight simulators and stuff like that. But again, those are based on a flat plane. So you have, you know, it's just from the ground up. How do you simulate an atmosphere? And then how do you do it with light? Logan had to make one that's on a sphere. So this is the same kind of thing as the fog sphere. It's just a shader on a sphere. And this shader is very fancy and does a lot of math that's based on actual atmospheric math. So we have the Rayleigh constant and the Mie constant, which are both like, you know, math principles that determine how light scatters through an atmosphere. And then we have some like hacky video game stuff so that we can hand tune it a little bit better. But you can see as I'm rotating around in the editor, we don't have the sun in this scene. But if the sun was here, you'd see that when we're looking at the sun through the atmosphere, it scatters through the atmosphere like this. And that's how you get sunset colors onto the Hearth. And it also creates a nice effect where, you know, the sun looks more like space photos when you're out in space, but when you're on Timber Hearth, it has that nice soft glow like we see from Earth.
And I guess by playing with the values of the atmospheres on different planets, you can achieve different colored refraction, right? And just different effects for you, and really make each planet feel like individual.
Exactly. So we just choose the base color of like the particulate in the sky. Mm-hmm. So it was kind of fun to try, like, you know, Giants Deep. Hey, what if we change it to green and you end up with like these red sunsets? And it was kind of fun to just like play around with, yeah, you know, what different atmospheres might look like. Okay. But that's not all. We have yet another tool, which is our ambient light system.
Yeah.
So this is basically, if I turn on lighting here, we don't have the sunlight, as I mentioned. So this is our ambient light. It's basically the light that, you know, in real life is bounce light, where, you know, the sunlight bounces around. So in shadows, you get like blue from the sky and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. We have our ambient lights are spherical. Normally in games, it's just like a color that you pick or maybe a texture that determines time of day ambient light. We have them on spheres. So what this is basically Logan wrote a clever tool that hijacks point lights. So if you plug a cookie into a point light in our game, it turns it into an ambient light. And we can control the outer radius, the inner radius. If you make it a shell, then the inside is dark, basically. So we use that for like caves in the middle of planets and things like that. Mm-hmm. We can control the intensity, just like other ambient lights, fall off, you know, things you'd be familiar with from ambient lights. And we also have textures here. And the texture is basically, I'll open this up in Photoshop. The texture is, it's got similar to the fog color ramp that I showed earlier. There are two axes. One of them is time of day, and the other one is basically a 3D map. So the horizontal axis goes from like nighttime to daytime back to nighttime.
And so then the vertical axis with time.
Yes, exactly. So based on your angle to the sun as a player, because it's not actually based on time, right? Since you can move around the planet.
That's right.
It's based on your angle to the sun. And so that'll be the horizontal axis. And then the vertical axis is basically, just draw some arrows here. On brush, don't be slow. So this color is the light that's coming from above an object. Okay. This color is the light that's coming from below, and this color is from the side. And so if we look at it in the game, come here. If I just grab like a gray sphere here in the editor, use that fancy snap tool.
New planet's really small.
Yeah, exactly. So you can see on the sphere, it's really easy to see the ambient light at nighttime here is, you know, this sort of darker color at the bottom, and it's brighter on the top to sort of simulate like light scattering through the atmosphere. But those are just hand-authored textures that we paint for each planet to make them lit the way we want.
Yeah, I think in other games, you know, you would go into, you'd probably go into the lighting settings for Unity and play with the overall ambient lighting for the scene. But for you, there are many different planets within this one scene, right? And so you can jump between them, and you can even have your probe on one planet and you're standing on another planet. So you can't just have it all have the same ambient lighting. They really need to have their own individual lighting. I guess this was the solution.
Exactly. So I can just quickly, like, just for fun, throw a different ambient light on Timber Hearth. So we'll grab the Hourglass Twins. So you can see that changes. You know, you have more reddish colors and like a strong red bounce light coming from below. Because on Hourglass Twins, you have the red canyon rocks. And so, you know, that bounce light is like faking the simulation of actual bounce light.
Yeah, so there's layers to this. Like, it's just really a bunch of layers that come together to make it just look. Each planet has three different layers. So we said, just to summarize, it was the fog, the atmosphere, but then the ambient lighting. And those three things come together to give the planet like this individual personality.
Exactly. Yeah. So once you combine all those, then you get, you know, a lot of the color palettes and whatnot that you see throughout the game.
That's amazing. So I think that was a great look at Timber Hearth. The gravity placement, just looking at the atmosphere. And now I think we can jump into our next planet, which is Giants Deep. So we'll do a little breakdown of that, and we'll stay on Wesley's screen share for this one. We'll just jump to the next planet and take a look at that. And a lot of people in chat were asking about the how did you do water? How did you do water?
Yeah, I saw someone in chat asking about the clouds too, so we can talk about that.
Yes. Yep. Okay. Yes. We have this question. How did you achieve the Ruby Darkbringer asks, hi, I'm wondering how you achieved the clouds in Giant's Deep. They look really pretty. We'll be talking about that definitely. So let's just jump right into it. So the ocean shader.
So the ocean shader is it's probably my single favorite shader that Logan made for the game. And it is very robust, and we use a lot of variants for different things in the solar system. So I'll talk about the ocean first, because that was sort of the template that, you know, when we were rebooting art, we used Giant's Deep as like a vertical slice, and we were like, okay, we need to have cool looking water to sell the planet, because that's most of what you see. And so we made the shader, and then I was like, hey, what if we hijacked it and did this with it? And Logan was like, oh, that's a good idea. And so we ended up using it all over the place. So the way the ocean shader works is this sphere is technically a cube. And it's hard to show because I would have to like edit the shader code, and I'm not a programmer, so I don't know how to do that. But essentially the way it works is there's a cube that then gets projected into the shape of a sphere. And that allows us to do height map stuff, which I said we couldn't do because everything's on spheres. But Logan created a clever workaround where we take this cube and snap it to a sphere. And so then we can tile square textures along it to create this height map blend. And I'll show you how we do that. So we have our surface shader here, which has got a lot of stuff going on. It's got some standard shader stuff like, you know, color and smoothness and all that. But the ocean itself is made up of these four height maps. And each one of the height maps is actually four height maps in one. So you can see RGBA here. We use each of the four channels for a different grayscale height map. And so we have different scales of them, essentially. So there's like these really tiny waves that you can see on the surface. There's big chunkier waves that create like the patterns overall. And essentially each channel is faded one to the other over time. So it'll like be red for a second, and then green for a second, then blue, then alpha, and then it'll loop back around. And then meanwhile, we have control over how fast these scroll across the surface, how much they displace the verts of the sphere, and like the time scale and some offset stuff so that it doesn't look super repeated. Another nice thing that makes the shader possible is that it's called the tessellated sphere renderer because it dynamically tessellates based on how close the camera is. Again, that's another thing that I can't really show without editing the shader code, but you'll just have to trust me that the ocean here is really high density. There's a lot of polygons and triangles.
Can you turn it into a shaded wireframe to perhaps maybe?
It doesn't actually work.
It doesn't actually
because of the shader.
Got it.
And I may have just. You can kind of see it.
Yeah. Oh my God, that's crazy to see.
Yeah. So you can see like over here. There's like lower density on the triangles.
Okay.
You can see like right there. There's a seam where it transitions from a higher poly to a lower poly. Mm-hmm. So that's. That's how that works. It's much easier to see with like a grayscale, but
yeah.
So all that displacement happens on the high poly stuff that you're close to. And then it has nice like transitions so there aren't seams. And then there's also another height map here, which we call chop. And this is specifically used in conjunction with the tornadoes. So you can see they sort of like pull the ocean up into them. Yes. That's basically a volume we have attached to the bottom of the tornado. And wherever that volume is, it adds the chop height map in addition to the others. And then we have the reverse as well. So for certain islands, we have calm zones that basically make the waves lower.
So if we were to hide one of the tornadoes, would it better illustrate what that chop looks like?
Yeah, I'll show the tornadoes more in a moment, but I can quickly do that. If I just turn off these meshes. Turn off. The top. Oh, it's not turning off. That's because I need to turn off the skinned mesh. There we go. So you can see it's pulling the waves up. And if I grab the ocean chop zone and move it around, that's what the tornadoes are doing, is they're moving around.
Okay.
And then in addition to all that, the ocean also has foam, which you can see on the chop here, which is basically whenever the height gets above a certain level, we add this sort of white texture to it so that it becomes more opaque and doesn't look very good with the lighting off, but you can see that it adds the foam to the top there.
Yeah, it makes it more clear. You just see the black and the white of the foam.
Yep. So that's a lot of the ocean shader. Let's see if there's anything else I missed here. It's also, you know, it uses other water stuff, so it has refraction, and if you look at something close, you can see that it's refracting the stuff under the water. It's kind of hard to tell. Maybe if I grab this light and make it really bright, you can see underneath the water it's refracting, like you would expect. So, you know, in addition to all the other fancy things it does, it also is water. And something that we took the effort to do, which a lot of games try and avoid, is we actually have a stencil so you can see both above and below the water at the same time.
Oh, wow. Okay.
A lot of games, you just like pop the camera one way or the other because it's a hard thing to handle. But since Outer Wilds is so much about naturalism and like the feeling that you're actually there in your suit, we wanted to handle that so that you could, you know, feel like you're bobbing up and down the water.
And how was the effect like of being underwater achieved? Just that, was that another kind of fog that, or like, does it use a similar system as a fog?
The underwater shader is probably more similar to a lot of underwater and video games. It's like a shader that, you know, renders fog and distorts things above the surface. You know, it's, we had to make it in the shape of a sphere, which was a challenge, but in other ways it's, you know, more typical, like what you'd see in a normal video game.
And the sphere is rendered on two sides so you could see it from the bottom as well?
Yeah, the ocean surface, we have it. So yeah, when you're looking up, it also refracts above the water.
Nice. Yeah, and then I guess we can then jump into looking at the tornado. And as you illustrated, when you opened up the tornado and the hierarchy, it's really made up of a bunch of things, right? There's the actual column of the tornado, and then there are these splashes around the edges of it. It's all to create that like visual effect. Maybe you can break that down.
Yeah. So gameplay wise, the tornadoes are basically these colliders, and they are sort of the change over time element of Giant's Deep. These aren't like scripted to happen in a specific way. They're just these objects that are spawned and they sort of follow a randomized path. And to get the visuals to match, you know, I'm a huge fan of like natural phenomena. I love looking at weather stuff, and I really wanted these tornadoes to feel like tornadoes instead of just being these like awkward columns. But because it's Outer Wilds and, you know, you actually get sucked up by the tornado, we couldn't just do like some fancy, you know, particle effect or something. That's actually had to resolve when you're inside of it. So we ended up tackling it with sort of a multi-pronged approach. The body of the tornado is a skinned mesh. So I just grabbed that. So it uses a skinned mesh renderer, and essentially it's rigged with a three-joint rig. So the middle, the top, and the bottom are all separate joints. And so when we move it, you know, it deforms. And this is how we sort of get the, you know, the twister type shapes, right? Where you get the cool S shape. Yeah. And the one in the middle. So these are like on a script that moves them around randomly. And the one in the middle also rotates a bit randomly, which helps it to look a lot more natural. They also scale a little bit, you know, so sometimes you get the really pointy tornado shapes and stuff like that. And that's all stuff that's controlled by a script where we set up all the possible varieties.
Does it also communicate with the gravity alignment tool in some way?
Yeah, so these are like handled more behind the scenes, but they do, you know, they align themselves to gravity because they're capsules, essentially, physics-wise. So the other thing about the skin to mesh render is we wanted to have vertex movements that it sort of feels like churning wind. And the way we do that is with vertex color. We heavily use vertex color throughout the game. It's a really like cheap way to get some cool effects. And so this shader basically takes, similar to the ocean, it like takes verts and wiggles them around. But instead of using a height map, it uses the vertex color. And so I went in and hand selected each loop of verts here and gave them a random vertex color so that what you get is, when I go back to the shaded view, you can see that each of those sort of hula hoops of vertex color is like churning slightly differently. Nice. And that's what creates that roiling surface feel.
Okay, nice. So it's like some kind of like scrolling vertex texture kind of thing.
Yeah, I can show the shader really quick. So it's got, you know, some scrolling textures on it that just sort of give it like surface movement. It's easier to see if I turn off the lighting.
There we go.
You can just see it sort of spiraling around. And then, yeah, it's got some alpha so that we can blend it better with these sort of like skirt meshes at the top and bottom. And these are separate meshes that are hooked up to the same rig, but they like rotate on one axis so that they, you know, don't overlap as much and don't look very tidy. And then back to this. It's got a normal map, and then it's also translucent, which is the same as the clouds. So we have this system that spawns lightning on the planet. And so when the lightning spawns in, you know, it sort of transmits through all the tornadoes and the clouds and feels more natural. Yeah. So real quickly, I'll mention that someone was asking about the clouds. Surprise, it's the same shader as the ocean. Like I said, we use this all over the place. That's the top, not the bottom. So this is basically, you know, it's the same concept. So it's using our tessellated sphere. We just render the other side of it. We have a height color ramp, which determines, like, you know, basically a fake thickness where, like, as the height goes up, we have more light bleeding through, so it feels like they're thinner. Mm-hmm. We have another one of those four-channel height maps that sort of scrolls around and fades from one state to the other so that we could get these nice, like, peaks and valleys here. And then, yeah, it's transmissive, so if you put a light in there, it just kind of glows. And then the surface is a completely different shader. It's more of like a typical, like, it's just a bunch of fancy textures scrolling around and moving on top of each other to create this sort of gas giant approach.
And so if that doesn't actually have a thickness, the cloud sphere, I believe when you fly through it, there is a time where you can't see anything. It feels like there's a thickness. Is that right? So how is that achieved?
Yeah, so in order to do that, we have a stencil, which is the same thing we use to get the camera to be able to see above and below the water at the same time. Mm-hmm. And the stencil is basically just, it takes, you know, this cloud mesh on one side and it takes this sphere on the other side. And when you're inside of that stencil, we just render fog. And so you don't see it in the scene here. But yeah, it just puts fog over the screen, essentially, when you're inside of there.
Oh, this is a great breakdown of it's deep. So when we're looking at the tornadoes, the there's the part at the top and at the bottom, right, where there's this rotating splashing particle effect. Is that how did you achieve that effect?
This specific part is not actually a particle effect. It's just a mesh, and we just layer them on top of each other and rotate them around.
Nice.
And they also have a little bit of vertex movement so that they don't feel as static.
Yeah.
But that is a good segue into one of the main effects of the planet, which is the island splashes, which John has been talking about.
Yeah, for anyone who doesn't know, like, you know, there are moments in this game where the islands of Giant's Deep get thrown into the air by the hurricanes and fall back down into the ocean.
Which happened during our demo this morning.
Which just happened. We just illustrated that. And John is going to break down how he achieved those splashes on them, or how they were achieved.
Yeah. So this effect, it's not the most flashy, but it is splashy. The way it works, if you can see my screen, is we have a separate bespoke mesh for each island where we trace the silhouette. And then we made a bunch of layers of meshes that trace around them. And essentially the splash material scrolls along it. So real quick, I'll show it in Maya to help illustrate that. So this is a statue island. It has a whole bunch of different layers. You can do that. So you see it's really high poly. And we have like 15 layered splashes in here. And we also have a splash in the center because there's some negative space in the middle of the island. So, you know, when you have the splash, you want to see that too, because that part's also going into the water. We care about details. So yeah, we make this close trace of the outside of the island with these layered meshes. But the reason that they're so high poly is because we use vertex movement on the water shader for the splash. So it gives it, you know, a little bit of like a watery, wiggly feel.
Yeah.
And it has this like singular part of like a little wave in the splash, which we have whole bunch of offset UVs, one for each splash mesh, and it scrolls along these. I can illustrate it more clearly in a test scene. which is called the Splash Zone. All right, yeah. So the thing that's cool about these is that the scale is really enormous, and you can see when you compare it to like this, you know, 1 meter cube, it's crazy. They're absolutely gigantic. But the way that they work is we have these timing curves that show they have the delay for, you know, between the island splashing down and the splashing, the splash meshes that play. We have a delay that sets that, and then the lifetime, so how long they last. And then for the lifetime, we have these two curves that basically progress both the texture and the cutoff of the texture. So one is for the UV movement, and the other is for this, as it dissipates, as it flies through the air. And you'll notice for each of these different meshes, the curves are slightly different. And I'll play it right here, now that I've talked about it enough, so you can see the whole thing in motion. We'll probably do it again. Yeah, so it's really slow because it's this absolutely gigantic island slamming into the water. So the water has to take a long time to, you know, get displaced and dissipate. Part of the reason we do this with meshes is because, you know, it's so large that particles wouldn't really cut it. You'd have to spawn so many particles, or the particles would be huge. And that would be kind of a disaster. Another thing that I'll show real quick is we have a splash for the player ship entering the water in Giant's Deep.
Nice.
I think
it's this one.
It should be longer.
It should be called Ocean Entry, I think.
Yeah, this one's Ocean Entry player ship. That's weird. Okay, I might be grabbing the wrong mesh, which is unfortunate, but we have a really long, like it's about that big, if you can see my cursor, splash for the ship entering the water on Giant's Deep, because we don't know how fast you're going to be going. Sometimes you're going like 500 meters per second as you splash into the water. So we have a really long one. I might have just grabbed the wrong mesh, so that no matter how fast you're going, you still see the splashes going down with you.
And that's kind of cool. And that's a great entrance to that, because like the first time you go in Giant's Deep, at least for me, that was like the biggest, one of the biggest like wow moments of this game, where I just flew in and I was like, oh my god, there's so much happening here. It's like a sensory overload.
Yeah,
I was not
sure.
Expecting it, because you don't see any of it from the outside because it's covered in clouds. And usually you're going in at high speed, so you just crash into the ocean. And so having that splash specifically made for that ship makes a lot of sense. And it shows the detail that you both put into the game. And I'm looking at this splash here, and I see it's shaped exactly around that specific island. Do you have a splash for each island that you
So we have one for each of the four. This is the construction yard, so you know, this is where the rings would live in here, and then this is the back part of the island. And so we also have one for the player and the probe, aside from the islands.
We got a question from the chat from Bluescape. I'm really curious. I'm assuming the movement of the tornadoes relies on the tool that locks the axis and position of props on spheres. How was this achieved before you had access to this tool? I guess they're talking about the gravitational snapping tool. Did you do this before you had access to that tool, or?
Yeah. So actually, in the original alpha build of the game, there are tornadoes on Giant's Deep, and they're basically just cylinders. A lot of stuff like that is done just through code. So the tool was basically created for artists so that we could prop out the game. But for physics objects and for a lot of like the stuff that changes over time, that's run by scripts that just, you know, it's the same kind of math where it's going to know like where to point and how to move it across the surface. But those are all handled in different ways, because like the tornadoes, for example, need to sort of, you know, move around in erratic patterns over the surface. And then, you know, they despawn when they hit an island and stuff like that.
If you check out my screen, by the way, I found the right model for the ship splash. You can see it's enormous, like compared to the side of that island.
Should we hit play mode? Do we see it play out? That animation?
Yes, the cutoff is pretty aggressive, so you might only see like the top part of it, but let's try it out. Because a lot of it is like bubbles as you're going down, so you might not see it at this distance. Yeah.
Oh, okay. I saw part of it.
Yeah. See the main part here.
Yeah.
Yeah, there you go.
Nice. Okay, really cool. And there's that little splash at the top, at the surface. That's nice.
Yep.
Because you could be outside of your ship when it falls.
That's true.
You could jump out. You know, who knows?
You have to really think, like most, like in a lot of games, you know, a lot of things are like smoke and mirrors. You'll hide a lot of stuff. It's hard to hide things in Outer Wilds, especially when you can like have a probe taking photos of things at any moment. And then,
like, yeah, and our players are very, very observant. So, yes. You know, generally the best thing is just don't hide it. We got to do it the right way because people will notice and they'll call us on it, which is cool.
Okay, so we'll jump from Giant's Deep. This was a great breakdown of Giant's Deep, really fantastic. And we'll jump to Brittle Hollow, another planet that has like a big feature right at the heart of it, which is the black hole, which I'm sure a lot of people on Twitter were asking, you know, if we were going to talk about the black hole on stream, and yes, we are. We're going to talk about that shader. So we're going to jump to Wesley's screen now.
So Brittle Hollow's thing is that, you know, it's built up of all these chunks, and over the course of the time loop, the chunks get damaged and they break off and they fall through the black hole at the center of the planet. So art-wise, it was one of the most difficult planets to make just because all of these chunks are hand-authored by design and they all have very specific shapes. VFX-wise, it's not quite as complex as Giant's Deep, but there are a couple things we're going to talk about. One of them is the black hole. And this is basically just a sphere. I'll toggle the geode on so you can see more clearly. But basically what this does is, similar to the atmospheres, we wanted it to actually feel like space exploration. So Logan, our technical artist, like looked up how black hole math works and, you know, basically made like a simplified version of it for this sphere. So, you know, it's not exactly what being inside of a black hole would look like, but based on the math, it's, you know, pretty close. And so you can see, like, as I get close to the event horizon here, you know, it's stretching out reality to infinity. And if you turn your camera around, you know, you can see like multiple copies of everything, kind of trippy. But yeah, it's just a sphere with a, you know, some black hole math on it. And it just refracts things around it. And then the white hole, same thing. It's, you know, just basically reversed.
Yeah, I just find it like hard to describe. Like, if I were to describe the shader to someone, it's just, there's so much going on. And as you said, it's very trippy. And I think that's probably, you know, just how black holes in real life are hard to describe.
Yeah, exactly. A lot of our philosophy for the game was, you know, because one of our core pillars is that it needs to feel like you're backpacking or hiking around a national park. When there's crazy stuff like a black hole, we wanted to take the same naturalistic approach whenever possible. So, you know, we made some concessions for gameplay in some situations, but for a lot of stuff, it was just like, let's try and make it close to the real thing and, you know, see what it's like and then go from there.
Yeah, and it has this feel, like the way it like kind of like visually pulls the environment into it. And like, you know, there are moments where you're just about to fly into it, but you're hovering over, but you feel like it's, even though it's not like, if you feel like it's sucking you in. I don't think it has any additional pull force, right? It's just regular gravity pulling you in, or does it?
There is regular gravity. I think when you get close enough, there is like a tiny force that it applies. I could be wrong on that.
Yeah.
But I think really, it has like a sort of a threshold.
Yeah, you do visually achieve the effect of like, it feels like it's just sucking everything in. It's very cool. And so, yeah, moving from the black hole, there, Brittle Hollow also has a moon, right, that shoots out volcanic rocks towards this planet, and that's kind of what's making the planet fall apart, right?
So, and we're gonna switch to John to talk
switch
about
to
that.
John's screen share to
let's talk about
those
meteors
rocks. Yeah, those meteors.
Okay, so you can see my screen. We're following Hollow's lantern around right now. It shoots out physically simulated meteors, so there's not like a preset animation path that they follow or anything. It's really just dependent on, you know, the positioning of the volcanoes and the force that they shoot these out and the gravity that attracts them. So sometimes they can go flying off into space, and, you know, that's fine because we wanted this to be, you know, more simulated, but it doesn't happen too often. Usually this one, which we'll watch, they land right on target. They hit the planet. So I'll drag out a prefab and I can show you guys how that works. Just get a little closer to the surface. All right, here's a meteor. First thing you'll notice is, hey, there's a light on it, which helps, you know, make these things feel like really glowy and intense. Okay, so the main shader on the meteor is this height blend. What we use the height blend for is to basically like represent the like heating and cooling of this meteor. Mm-hmm. So we have a height map for the level of the like rocks on the meteor, and then it blends with basically a, we call it a glow level, but it's like the level of the lava. We have a control for like, you know, the width of that blend as well. But so when it, the meteor is really hot and it's just been shot out of Hollow's Lantern, it'll be super bright, and then it cools over time, and then as it enters the atmosphere, it starts to heat up again. Mm-hmm. Which is, you know, just a nice little way to make it feel physical.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's just got regular materials other than that blend. But I can break down the particles as well, because those are neat. So we have 8 particle systems for the shrapnel of the meteor when it bursts. So each particle system corresponds to a specific part of the mesh. So for example, if I highlight this, Meteor Shard 1, this is like a specific cutout that we took of the meteor. So it's not like, you know, random bits. These are the 8 component parts of the meteor with a particle system for each one. Which, you know, helps it feel a little bit more believable when it breaks. It's not breaking into arbitrary pieces. It's, you know, the pieces that it would break into.
Right.
We have 2 other effects called the lava and the juice, which you cannot drink, that show, you know, like the liquid explosion of it when it lands. Yeah. We have one that's larger scale. We have one that's smaller scale because it just helps it to feel a little bit more physical when you have kind of that layering. Then that's most of it. But another thing we have is a smoke trail, which we can't show if we're not in play mode, because it basically it spawns smoke particles as it moves. But, okay, you know, if this thing isn't moving, you won't see them. Another cool thing I want to show is just as an example from what we were talking about related to the Adel Rock about creating terrain. This bridge is a good example of the unexpected challenges of building on spheres. Mm-hmm. So, you know, obviously the first level of it is that, yes, it's curved around the curvature of the planet. But it's so wide that when we first made this asset, we made it flat like this, and you could feel yourself like being tilted off alignment from gravity when you were standing on this when it was flat. Yeah. So this thing, if you look, it's actually it's curved like this, you know, in the perpendicular axis to the main curve, right, so that you know, you're always in alignment, which is, you know, a neat little touch. And also, of course, it's broken into chunks because this is brittle hollow and certain pieces of this are going to fall over.
When you were modeling these things in I think you said Maya, right? Did you build them flat and then deform them after the fact?
It depends. A lot of the time usually we'll make like a base mesh curved, and then, you know, we can just, you know, edit the fine details after that once the shape is right. But yeah, in this case, like, you know, we weren't going to make it over again. So, you know, Maya has a lot of pretty good like bend deform tools and, you know, soft selection and stuff that you can use to help out with that at least.
When you built the environment, you built the model in Maya, but then you also had, you broke it all into pieces.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. So I wasn't on the team during that time, so I can't say, maybe Wesley knows exactly what the process was, but I'm assuming this was modeled whole and then cut into pieces.
Yeah, it's a lot of brittle hollow, like I said, is hand-tuned by the designers. So for a bridge like this, you know, it went through several iterations in gray box phase where it's just like really low poly, really simple. And it's only after a lot of play testing that they determined, okay, we want, you know, 2 main bridges and, you know, this number of chunks. And so that was all determined by designers before we ever started making the art for it. So once we had, you know, essentially that gray box mesh to start from, that gave us the target for like, okay, how much does it need to curve? How big should it be? And then from there, it's, you know, sometimes art will just take the gray box directly. Other times it's easier to start with a different process and just try and match it. For this one, I think it was a combination of both. Mm-hmm. And then, yeah, once it's modeled out, you know, making the fractures at the right point and getting all the detail in there was just a lot of, you know, elbow grease, as much of the game was.
Yeah.
And when the pieces break apart, is it always in the same order? Is there some randomization there?
No, it's actually entirely simulated. So as John mentioned, like the meteors fire out at random intervals, mm-hmm, and the meteors causing damage to the planet is what causes chunks to fall. So there's a bunch of fancy scripting going on so that, you know, certain pieces are more likely to fall than others. They did a lot of like tests where they would just like, you know, have Brittle Hollow run like 100 times and see what the averages were to make sure that, like, you know, you don't have the wrong pieces falling too early and stuff like that. But it is ultimately random on each playthrough.
Okay. And when the pieces do fall apart, there's a particle effect that plays on the edge, right, of each piece.
Okay. Yeah, so a little thing I'll show, and certain ones are more visible with or without lighting, but you can kind of see this one. The sparks is the coolest one. There. So what we have is we have this custom line emitter that we use to basically trace the path around each fragment to show where the particles should emit from. Because, you know, making a model for that, for each of them, would be about as time consuming maybe as making these lines, but it does save mesh memory. And so, you know, this is ultimately easier to render, I would say, is we have this cool custom line emitter tool where we, I think I have to turn gizmos on to see it.
Oh, there we go. I was going to ask. Yeah.
Yeah. It's the red. Can we, yeah, so let's try this. Yeah, you can kind of see it a little bit better at least. So what's going on is we have all the vertices in these fields, and the particles emit from those. So we have three different effects that play when the fragments break off for, you know, sparks, dust, and rocks, because we really wanted to get, like, all that natural feeling scale. You know, there's, like, a large, medium, small structure to a lot of things in nature. So we want, you know, rocks and then, you know, accompanying sparks and dust. Yeah, there's one of these line renders on every single Brittle Hollow fragment that breaks off, tracing the silhouette. There we go. That's a better way to show it. See it around there. It's faint, but depending on the resolution, hopefully that's pretty visible.
Yeah, and again, adds to that feeling of realism, right? You could have just spawned like a particle system in the general area, but you actually made sure it emitted from specifically that line, right?
Because then it communicates the gameplay more clearly too.
And so did you integrate that with the particle system, this line renderer, or was the particles are shot out with the particle system, but
Line renderer, I believe, determines the emitter for the particle system. Nice. So I think there's some script stuff going on that makes it not hook into this exactly. I don't know quite how that works, but instead of emitting from a shape like in the emission field, it emits from this line.
Okay, so that's everything we had to talk about for Brittle Hollow. We can jump to the next planet, the Hourglass Twins, and we're going to jump to Wesley's screen for this, and we're going to talk about, you know, a whole bunch of sand.
It's a lot,
lot of sand stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we'll dive. Maybe we can start with the sand column. So for anybody who's not aware, Hourglass Twins, essentially two planets that share this sand column going between them, and the sand is moving from one of the planets to the other over the course of the loop, right? And so maybe we can start with that sand, how that was achieved.
Yeah, so the sand column, similar to the tornadoes, is, you know, it's a physics system that was determined in the gray box. It's in the original alpha of the game. It's just like a cylinder there. And so we knew what it needed to do, which is, you know, it rotates, or it connects the equators of both planets. And so, you know, as one planet is draining of sand, it transfers to the other. And if the player or the ship is caught in the column, it pulls you to the other side. And so, you know, we wanted it to feel like a bunch of sand grains instead of just this arbitrary cylinder. Mm-hmm. And so one of the things we did is we created this this height map, basically. So I'll go to the shader really quick. We baked out height maps for Ash Twin. And for Ember Twin, you can see their Cave Twin and Tower Twin, which is the working names. And so you can see, like, as the sand gets blocked by these bits of terrain, less of it comes through. We still needed some to come through because it needs to communicate to players that it's going to pull them off. But we wanted it to visually look like, you know, the sand is coming through pores in the rocks rather than just arbitrarily going through the planet. Yeah. The problem is if you take, like, you know, just a cylinder and do that, it just looks like an empty cylinder. And it was really a challenge to get this to feel like, you know, a dense column of sand, because, you know, you try like a bunch of tiny cylinders and it becomes very obvious that it's just a bunch of little cylinders. So we tried a bunch of different shapes, and the final solution that we went with is basically this 3D maze pattern, which I'll just show on a cross section. So you can see it's this crazy, like, it's basically a maze where it's like one plane that wraps around itself like a brain.
Could you zoom into that a little more?
Do that. Maybe turn on lighting.
Oh, yeah. Nice.
Yeah. So you can see, you know, it's just this plane that goes around and it has vertex movement and stuff on it. Yeah. And, you know, the scrolling texture, but this shape allowed us to get that sort of feeling of density, both, you know, if you're falling through it this way, you know, you'll see all these different pathways and it doesn't feel like you're just inside of a cylinder.
Yeah.
And then, you know, when you see it from the side, you see that cool cutout and it's got like lots of different columns inside of it. Because you can see, like, without the column in there, if I turn lighting back off, you know, it's just this weird empty void inside. That doesn't look very convincing.
Mm-hmm.
But with this, it feels like a bunch of sand.
Yeah.
So that's the column. The sphere, which is basically like the system of the planet, right, where sand drains from Ash Twin and fills up Ember Twin, is basically another catch-all use of our tessellated sphere renderer.
Yeah, I love how many times that's actually used. And that's great, right? Why make something entirely new if you can reuse your tools, right?
Yep. So this is, you know, this tessellated sphere just scales up over the course of the game. If I click on the shader, you can see it's basically the same setup. It's got height maps that change over time. They change very slowly. And the reason for that is, like, as it's filling up, you don't just want one peak to like go, because it doesn't feel like the sand is organically filling in the sphere.
Yeah.
So by having the height maps blend, it's sort of like very slow water as the sand expands. And if you do like a time lapse, you can see what that looks like. And yeah, other than that, it's, you know, obviously it's not water, it's sand. So we have this normal map that's tiled a bajillion times, giving it that nice like sparkly sheen on there. It's probably hard to see the noise over the stream, but we wanted it to have that nice speckly feeling. And the other cool thing about the sand sphere is we wanted to, similar to the column, we wanted to justify, like, you know, this is porous rock that's, you know, the sand is coming through it. It's not just like this weird sphere that expands. And so what we did is we actually made this communicate with the terrain shader. I'm just going to undo and go back to when it's small. Doesn't seem to be doing it here, which makes it hard to demo. I'm going to try reloading the scene really quick and just see if I broke something.
We'll take a question in the meantime. Jezzy Jez says, how did you guys deal with making sure you're always working with the correct scale in mind? It seems incredibly tricky. Did you have a tool of the player model and ship that you can easily pop up anywhere? What method did you use?
Yeah, that's a good question. So in, as I mentioned, like much of the game is determined by the game designers. And so in Maya, like these planets are just very low poly. And they have essentially a proxy player that's like a 2 meter tall capsule and a proxy ship that's like a 15 meter sphere. And so, you know, whenever they're making design stuff, it's like, okay, you know, we need to make sure the ship can land here. So they'll grab that sphere and like throw it down and be like, okay, you know, this is a good landing zone. Whereas, you know, we don't want people to land down there. And obviously, because it's Outer Wilds, you know, you can crash your ship down there if you want, but it might be hard to get it out. But yeah, there's a lot of that kind of stuff throughout development where, you know, design would have like, okay, we have this very specific, like, here's the landing zone and here's the pathway. And then art would, you know, make the landing zone too small or something. And it's like, okay, we have to go back and look at the gray box again. And so our art team sort of became like half level designers where they had to learn just intuitively, like, okay, you know, these parts are pathways. We need to be super rigid. This is the surface. We can be a little bit more flexible with it. And we have very, like, detailed handoffs between the designers and the artists so that they, you know, make sure they stick the design goals. All right, let's see if the shader works now.
You can see it. Just The height map is changing as it grows.
I wonder if I need to set something here. Or maybe, you know what? I bet I need to scale this part. Because that's the physics object. There we go. Okay. I'll turn the lighting back off. You can see when the sphere gets close to the surface of the terrain, we actually have a height map of the porous rock, and the sand will come through the pores in the rock before it actually, like, the mesh clips through. Right. So not only does that help to, like, blend the visual transition, but it's also a nice tell for players of, like, oh no, the sand is starting to come.
Yeah.
So that was a nice touch that we were able to get in.
And so is the terrain generator speaking to this sphere, basically? Is that what's happening? Like the,
or... Yeah. So I can show the terrain generator really quickly. We use something similar for all the planets, so it's not a bad thing to cover. So it's basically, we have a tool that takes all of our geometry and bakes it before, like, the final version of the game. And what this allows us to do is basically create a second UV set based on the pivot of the planet. And based on that pivot, we have this nice gradient. So you can see, like, in the canyon, if I turn off the sand, you can see there's, like, this gradient from, like, dark rocks in the middle to light rocks. Timber Hearth has something similar.
Right.
And that really helps to sell the scale of the planet, because otherwise, you know, you're just looking at this one hue of red and you have no depth cues.
Right.
And so we have that element. And then in addition, you know, we have different floor and wall textures, and so the floor texture here has a height map as part of it. So if I just go to that texture, make this a little bit bigger, you can see the alpha channel. So that's essentially what the sand sphere talks to, and it's like, okay, you know, come up through the pores first before you go across the rock.
Oh, okay, nice. So it's literally like using that texture to know where the sand should come out is the dark spots. So it uses the dark spots on that texture to.
Yep. And so then, you know, there's a sand texture that basically overwrites the floor texture when those conditions are met.
Oh, I see. Okay. So it's separate from the sphere itself and then blends into the sphere later, basically.
Exactly. Yeah. We tried to make it look as much like the sphere as possible. So it uses the same, like, tiling and textures and everything, but it's actually completely different because it's handled by the terrain instead of the tessellated sphere.
Yes, at first I thought it was something like how the tornado was pulling the sphere up, like an outwards, but I see you've used a different, so same foundation, but then different little tricks to achieve what you're,
exactly,
the unique case of each planet. That's great.
Yeah.
We take a few more questions. Faulty Pine asks, what version of Unity was this made in?
It's a complicated question.
Yeah.
Basically, the original version of the game, I think it was Unity 3. It might have been Unity 4. And that's what the alpha was built in. Mm-hmm. And one of the first things we decided as a team at Mobius is, like, do we upgrade or not to Unity 5, which has, like, the standard shader and physically based rendering and all that stuff? You know, because before it was, like, you know, spec maps and all that. And so that was, like, our first big overhaul. And then working with Annapurna, it's like, okay, you know, now we have more direct link to Unity. We can get them to help us, like, fix performance problems and stuff. But that meant we needed to upgrade again, which was challenging because NVIDIA physics actually changed fundamentally. I think it was before Unity 5 that physics changed. And basically we had to, like, redo the physics of the entire game at that point. So it was... The version that we shipped in is Unity 2017, and the version that we shipped, Echoes of the Eye, is 2019, because we upgraded again.
Because we didn't learn our lesson.
it was
worth it.
We had reasons, but yeah, it was a challenge to upgrade every time, because so much stuff is very specific for the game.
I can imagine. DFrog ever asked, how do you not be lost about all of this? How do you organize this type of content? I guess maybe they're referring to the scale of things and organizing maybe how you approach tackling the challenges of each planet.
Is all we have really good producers. That's part of it.
Absolutely. That's a good answer.
Yeah. Producers help a lot. We also follow very strict, like, hierarchy and naming conventions. So you can see, like, you know, we have the sector system, which is basically our substitute for LODs. So you know, the planets are broken up in different sectors. So this one has North Hemisphere, South Hemisphere, and then there are sectors within those. So you'll have like, you know, the surface versus the underground. And those are like custom built for design reasons, but also performance reasons. And so, you know, within each of these sectors, we have folders to organize like, okay, is it, you know, geometry? Is this our LOD mesh? Is it VFX? You know, is this like something that's really important for design, so only designers should mess with it and not artists? So we organize stuff that way. And then in our project, we have very like consistent naming conventions where, you know, we label things very quickly. So it's like, you know, I know if I want to search for a plant, I'm going to type in foliage or tree or something like that. We have a whole big document to organize and onboard everybody. So a lot of it is just elbow grease, and you know, we're all kind of obsessed with the game, so we just know the game really well.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's definitely a lot of organization and project management too.
Yeah, that's a great question. Thank you, D Frog Ever. I have my own question. But because you mentioned LODs, right? And I'm just very interested in, there's like a very seamless blend from when you're entering a planet or from when you're leaving the planet to how the LODs change. So I'm guessing like when you're looking at Giants Deep is a good example of this. When you're looking at it, it has its own kind of like texture scrolling around the planet. And I just wonder, is that the, we're probably not looking at a high poly, high res version of the planet, right? When we're further away. So I'm wondering what that
is. That's correct. Is. Yeah. Much like most of Outer Wilds, it's done by hand.
Okay.
So essentially, we went and hand built these low poly meshes.
Yeah.
And if I turn on wireframe, it'll be easier to tell. So you can see this is just a low poly version. Sometimes this was, you know, created in ZBrush. Other times it was in Maya. But it was, you know, like if you compare that to the actual surface, there's a lot more topology going on there. And these are just hand authored. They have custom textures that are sort of atlas. So you can see, like, there's all the different textures used on the surface. And so, yeah, it's hand built. And we did that because, you know, we needed to make sure that landmarks were visible from a distance, and you can be going very fast in the game, as we mentioned earlier. So,
yeah.
You know, in, you know, cases where your processing speed might not be as fast, or you don't have as much RAM, we wanted to make sure that you weren't like super disoriented by some, you know, crummy low poly thing that you can't tell what it is. Right. So we needed enough detail in the low poly version that you could still navigate while the rest of it is streaming in.
Yeah. Just a little tidbit. Something interesting about that, though, is if you leave your ship or a probe on a planet, it will not go to its LOD version.
Yep.
So I understand the probe, but why the ship?
The ship, we can make the visuals go to the LOD version, but we still need the physics to run. So yes. On like, you know, Brittle Hollow, we have, you know, all the meteors are still going and hitting stuff. And we have like LOD versions of some of the physics systems that, you know, are close enough for when you're not there. But, you know, for example, like if your ship is parked on Hourglass Twins and the sand column hits it, it needs to get pulled to the other side.
Yeah.
So we can't LOD all of the stuff off like you can in some other games because the ship and the probe are affected by physics.
Right. That makes sense. And how many LODs does each planet have?
Most planets, it's like, you know, we try and get it down to one renderer when you're at a distance.
Okay.
You can see this one has like a separate renderer for Nomai stuff. And then there's something here. I don't even know what this is. I think it's the little thing that you pick up with your signal scope. Yeah. So, you know, occasionally we have like more than one, but we tried to get it as close as possible to one renderer because, you know, when you're on another planet, we still need to be able to see this, but we don't want it to be super expensive.
Okay, so I think I have a few other questions. Have you used any mesh deformations that happen in play mode? If so, how difficult and demanding is such a technique?
We do use blend shapes in a couple of places. Mm-hmm. The ship damage has some blend shapes, and then we also use them on the comet for the melting ice. But those are the only cases. In most cases, it's, you know, we don't use a lot of deformation stuff because it is expensive.
Okay, so we're gonna go on a short like 5 to 10 minute break, so please stick around. When we're back, we're gonna dive right into Dark Bramble And we'll be talking about fog and volumetric fog lights and all sorts of spooky things that you can find in Dark Bramble. I know it's a highly requested topic, so stick around and we'll be right back. Yeah. And now we're going to jump into Dark Bramble. But first, I was curious. I wanted to ask Wesley and John, you've been working on this game for a while. I'm just personally curious. What's your personal favorite planet? Like, mine is Giant's Deep. I love Giant's Deep. I don't know why. Sometimes I go there, I finished the game, but I like to just go there, dive in and take it all in. Like, it's just so, like I said before, it's like a sensory overload. It's so intense. I'd love to hear yours and like why.
Well, I think my favorite is Brittle Hollow. So I actually played this game as a fan before I got hired. Nice. So I guess kind of a different perspective on it. But I remember playing through Brittle Hollow and seeing the planet fall apart. And I remember walking along one of the like inverted pathways with the gravity crystals and seeing, just this incredible view of the shattered planet around me. And I was like, man, this video game is really good. Those like memories of going through Brittle Hollow for the first time. I just love the way that it changes so drastically over the course of the loop. And also I think the geodes look really cool. So yeah, Brittle Hollow for me.
Wesley, you were there from the beginning. What's yours?
I'm gonna have a three-pronged answer. I think Brittle Hollow is my favorite to play. I just love like gravity shenanigans. Giant's Deep is my favorite aesthetic because like I mentioned, I'm sort of like a weather nerd. I was really into the movie Twister when I was a kid, and so like getting to make these giant tornadoes was awesome.
Nice.
But Timber Hearth is special to me because it's I grew up in the Redwood Forests, and so when I joined the project, and Timber Hearth was already sort of this like pine environment, I was like, hey, it would be cool on tiny planets, really big trees.
Mm.
So it's sort of like the environment is loosely based off of where I grew up, so it's a bit special as well.
That's amazing. So Timberhearth kind of feels like home to you.
Exactly.
and it has that like quality in the game too. It is the home planet. You're supposed to feel comfortable there. There are not a lot of things trying to kill you on Timberhearth, unless somehow you go into one of those like geysers that just shoots out. But yeah, great answers. Okay, cool. So let's dive right into Dark Bramble. We'll share John's screen right now. To John's screen share.
All right, let's do it. So here we are in Dark Bramble. The main deal with Dark Bramble is that it's like a 3D maze. You're stumbling around the fog, traveling through basically different dimensions within the planet itself, trying to find wherever you're going. So sometimes you're following a signal, sometimes you're trying to follow a light.
On my screen right now.
Oh, we are?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So let's switch to John's screen. Perfect.
Cool.
There we go.
Yeah, I was just showing Dark Bramble, so no big deal. Okay, so the coolest thing that I want to show with Dark Bramble is that we can turn off the fog in the editor, and people can see what it really looks like behind the veil, as it were. Let's see if this is a good one. I think this is, this image. So here's the Dark Bramble with no fog. It looks really interesting because you can see, all the twisting vines around you in a way that normally you couldn't. But the weirdest part of it for me when I turn this off, if I can find one, is you can see the anglerfish a lot better, but they can't see you. It kind of puts my nerves on edge to see them just lurking there. They're there.
Yeah.
Something you can see pretty clearly here is there's like a custom kind of lens flare fog light. Around the light there, and you can see it over there too. We use these to help players navigate in the fog, because otherwise, you barely have anything in front of you, it'd be pretty difficult. So we have a little system for those lens flares where we can determine like the minimum and maximum visible distance. So if you're far enough away from them, we have like this custom sprite basically that shows up as you approach them. And when you get close enough, it turns into just like a regular light. Let's go around in the editor just a bit while I'm safe. I'm not going to wake up the anglerfish this way. I just thought this would be a cool thing for players to see, what the whole environment looks like. And if we go a little bit further out and play mode, you can see, need to find it. Yeah, here. All the dark bramble dimensions laid out at once. So they hang out somewhere in space, away from the planet. I think I've seen some bugs on like Reddit and stuff where you can see these, so some hardcore Outer Wilds fans, this might be familiar to them. But they each have their little entrances, and then, you know, inside them are the bramble spheres for the exits. And these spheres are absolutely enormous. So if I go grab, Dark Bramble itself, so like a really, really large space to work with. So I'm sorry that the camera is a little bit of a struggle, but we'll get there. Okay, got them both on my screen. So now we'll move Dark Bramble into one of the fog spheres, and you'll see the scale. A little like this. And do that a bunch of times, and eventually we'll get there.
I think there's a question in chat about the mysterious black sphere.
Yes.
Around Dark Bramble.
Yeah, so you want to talk about that, Wesley?
Yeah, the reason for that is because when your probe is inside of here, the little scout, you know, we essentially we're using all of our layers for other stuff, so we can't just disable some renderers and not others. So we have to have these renderers on if you're taking scout pictures. But that, of course, reveals the illusion that Dark Bramble's actually there in space. So we just, you know, put a black sphere on it and put it in a place where players aren't very likely to look under the sun. So that's what that is.
Yeah, so that's why it's in that sneaky place. But yeah, you can see Dark Bramble fits neatly in one Bramble sphere. And the exterior of Dark Bramble is pretty big, so you could probably fit the whole solar system in the different Bramble dimensions, which is kind of wild. And you can see the all the cool twisting vines and stuff. One of our artists made a pretty interesting like process talk at my school before I got hired, like a while before, about how these work. But basically, it's a smooth like twisting mesh in Maya, and then we have like a tiling height map in ZBrush that like deforms it to give it that like segmented bramble vine pattern, which is neat.
I think if you go back through our posts on our Mobius blog on our website, we have a tutorial somewhere, or at least like a little process thing with different screenshots of that process if you want to look it up. Probably circa 2018, so a while ago.
If anyone finds that, maybe we can like post that in the chat somewhere.
You know, other than that, that's mostly it for Dark Bramble. We use standard video game trickery to teleport you between these different points when you go through the Bramble spheres. And something some people might have run into is that, like, in the Angler Nest dimension, we commit a little crime where no matter which side you go in from, you always come in through here, so you barely pass by these three angler fish as you approach the eggs. These eggs have a cool material, which Wesley will talk about very soon. Well, something related to it.
That's a good segue.
Should we jump to Wes's screen share? Okay. So we'll cue Wes's screen share now. We'll jump to that.
So one thing that we use across the game and all over the place is a fancy shader that makes use of BRDFs, which is an acronym for bidirectional reflectance distribution function, which I had to read out because I can never remember it. But basically what BRDFs are is it's a custom lighting model. So if you're familiar at all with like 3D modeling, you know, you'll have in Maya like your Lambert shader, your Phong shader. Unity has the standard shader. So these are all like, you know, ways that the code tells a surface how to respond to lighting. The BRDF is basically a texture that does the same thing. So it allows us to create really complex lighting models for surfaces without having to make like super unique shaders for each one. It's just one shader, and then we just plug in different BRDFs. So you can see that pretty clearly on the comet, which is one of the main places we use it. So if I turn on this point light, you can see that it's, you know, this like crystalline ice that, you know, refracts light around. If I look at it from different angles, you know, if I put the light on one side, look at it from the other side, it like glows through. If I look at it from this side, it has very different lighting. And that's all driven by a texture. So I will open up the shader for it. this one. So you can see it's this fancy shader here, but it's just a normal map and a smoothness map, but it's got a BRDF lookup ID. So we have a registry where we like assign these. Logan essentially hacked into like some part of the Unity rendering pipeline, and so we had to use like, we only have 8 slots for this because it's some like bit that he hijacked. So we have these 8 that are like predetermined. There's actually one that's unused, but we use this for the geode, gravity crystals, Nomite glass, the ice on the comet, ghost matter, the anglerfish eggs, and the a mystery object from Echoes of the Eye, which I'll talk about later. And so you can see these textures look really strange. I'll open up the gravity crystal one, which is just sort of our template. I'll make it a little bit bigger so it's easier to see here. So basically what this texture does is one axis is the angle of the light to the object, and the other axis is the angle of the player camera to the object. And so what that gives you is like a grid where it can look up and be like, okay, if the player is looking directly at the surface and the light should be bouncing into their eye, we're going to give it this color. And if you're on the other side and you're looking at the back and the light is filtering through the object, we're going to give it this color. And so it's basically a range of all possible like coordinates of those two things on both axes here. The left half, fun fact, is actually physically impossible. You can't be in those scenarios, but you know, it's a square texture, so we just don't use the left half. So basically you have like your specular highlight here, and then you have like your transmission through the object and then the surface of the object. So we often use this for things like crystals or ice, where it's like the lighting model might be really complicated and we don't want to actually do all that in a shader. We just sort of hand paint these BRDFs and field them out until they look right. So I can open up the comet since I was showing that one.
So do you like open the texture up and then you paint into it and then you just plug it in, see how it looks, go back? The process is just to go back and forth?
Yeah, so it looks like, right to you? Essentially, when Logan wrote the shader, he like generated a template that's like, okay, here's, you know, it was like some glass orb. And he like made a texture that made it look more or less like the reference material. And then from that, we sort of figured out like as artists, like, okay, paint here if you want to affect this, paint here if you want to affect this. And it's sort of just like an intuitive thing that, you know, eventually you sort of get the hang of and, you know, see the matrix, and then you just kind of do it. So you can see on the comet, there's like some sort of like speckly light filtering through, and then it gets really bright when the light is behind it, and then really shiny as well. And it's sort of like a mottled color. And so you combine that with the normal map and you get all these really complex interactions with the light that look pretty interesting.
Is this, how did you come to this, like, I guess, technique for lighting?
We basically came up with this because one of the core, like, gameplay things are gravity crystals. Mm-hmm. And so we already knew that those were going to be a thing, and we wanted to have them all over the place. And pretty early on in development, we came up with the idea of making Brittle Hollow into, like, a giant geode. And so, you know, it's like, okay, we're going to use those geode crystals, or, like, the unfiltered version. Gravity crystals are refined. So we knew that like crystals were going to be a big part of the visual direction of one of the planets. And so it was like, okay, how do we want to make crystals? And we just did a bunch of research, and this was the most expedient way to get the effect that we wanted.
And what else in the game uses this BDRF technique? BRDF technique?
So we use it on the comet. We use it on all the little like ghost matter crystals. If I go into the middle here, you know, this shader that's used on the little crystals and on the core as well, it's the same thing. So if I grab that point light, move it in here, you can see this has similarly like strange lighting properties. So, you know, it glows when the light is behind it, and then if the light's in front of it, it's like shiny blue. And those are like effects that you can create, you know, with just code in a shader. Mm-hmm. But it was much easier for us to iterate and create variety by just turning it into a texture.
And since we're here, you know, on the interloper, like we promised to go from one planet to the other, we might as well do it. Just could you just quickly break down, you know, for anyone who's not aware, it's like an ice comet, right?
Yeah.
It covers completely in ice. that melts over time as it gets closer to the sun. Yep. Can you just talk about how that was achieved?
Yeah, the melting is like fairly standard. We just use a blend shape in Maya. Mm-hmm. So I can just grab the blend shape number here. We made multiple iterative blend shapes because that gave us more control over the effect. So we have like this one that translates the verts this way. We have one that sort of like peels back. If I go at an angle, you can see it like the top sort of melts away first. Mm. We have one that does it even further. Essentially, it's like from the side, it's cut into these layers. And so we can have, you know, the different stuff melt at slightly different rates, which makes it feel a bit more organic. And yeah, it's just the sun like talks to these numbers. So as the comet approaches, you know, I think it probably goes this way where it like gradually peels away.
So the mesh was modeled in a way that like it's actually different meshes that meet and then you're just pulling them apart from each other, right? You're not splitting the mesh at any point.
Correct. Yeah, it was, yeah. Trying to remember exactly how I modeled it. I'm pretty sure I modeled it in like the open position first, mm-hmm. and then like snapped the edges together to create the blend shapes. Okay. And then the tricky part was we wanted it to feel seamless because game design wise, you're supposed to find a clue that teaches you about this.
Yeah.
So we didn't want it to be obvious that that's what was going to happen if you just see the ice. So I had to make like a seamless mesh and then reproject the normals onto the blend shape version. So that, you know, it doesn't look like there's a seam there. It's just seamless.
And then what happens when it breaks apart? Does that projection still work just fine on the as it opens up?
Or do you have to reproject? It looks a little bit weird because you can see like the normals on the edge here, like a bit strange. Mm-hmm. But you know, it's melting and you're right next to the sun, so most people don't notice that it looks weird.
Got it. And yeah, so it's also speaking to the distance of the comet to the sun, right? And it's. That's what's making it track along the blend shape?
Yep, exactly. So it's just, you know, we have this curve in here for how the ice goes, and it's just communicating with the sun and the middle of the comet and distances from the sun and all that.
All right. Okay, so I think we've covered everything in the base game. Yep. And we're about to talk about the DLC. Right, so big spoiler warning for everything in Echoes of the Eye. If you haven't played Echoes of the Eye and you don't want it spoiled, because you know this is a knowledge-based game, basically get like anything you see here will kind of like ruin the experience, then walk away. And yep. you can come back and watch the VOD when we upload it to YouTube after you're done playing the game. But if not, yeah, we're gonna dive right into Echoes of the Eye, starting with Wesley. Maybe you can talk about the art direction philosophy for Echoes of the Eye.
I think if we can switch to John's screen, he's going to just play through it while I'm talking about stuff.
Yeah, yep. Perfect.
Yeah,
we'll switch to John's screen share. Okay. So,
as I mentioned before, Echoes of the Eye was originally conceived as sort of like a, you know, we're going to do a quick DLC and it's going to be Halloween themed. We want to like lean into like the horror elements and, you know, essentially make like another location in the solar system. There's sort of a fun tidbit, which is when we initially had our FIG campaign for crowdfunding, one of the stretch goals was the invisible planet. And that sort of grew over time and evolved into what Echoes of the Eye became. So that was sort of one of the seeds. But yeah, basically, we tried a bunch of stuff. And, you know, we originally had like some other ideas for what the DLC would be. And then there was the idea of wanting to explore the concept of river rafting, because that's like an environment that we don't have anywhere in the game. And from the idea of having a river, it was like, oh, what if it was on the inside of a ring and you could sail around the entire environment? Mm-hmm. So it's almost like a microcosm of the ship exploring the solar system. So it gave the designers some like new mechanics to try out. And then, you know, we got to draw from different art style or art inspirations for the environment as well. So, you know, the terrain here is sort of inspired by like southern U.S. like marshlands and swamps, as well as like whitewater rafting and then some coastal environments as well, because Giants Deep ended up being more like islands. And so having like these coastal cliffs was kind of a fun thing for us to play with as well. Yeah. One of the big things we wanted to do narratively is, you know, we have this concept of like there's the real world, and then there's the world that you enter when you go to sleep. And we wanted to distinguish those two things because narratively, huge spoilers, obviously, you know, the sleeping world, the dream world, as we call it internally, is designed to mimic the home world of this species. And the ring world is also designed to mimic it, but the ring world is old. It's, you know, aged significantly. Yeah. And so we wanted to create a contrast, or like when players go to sleep and they wake up in that dream, everything is like fresh and new and, you know, lush. So it's like, essentially, this is the world as they remembered it, whereas the ring world is like this dilapidated, decaying thing, just like a lot of Outer Wilds.
Yeah.
So creating that sort of dichotomy was a huge deal. And then the other interesting tidbit is that in the dream world, because it's like a separate space that you go to, we made it flat. So it's the only part of the game that's not on a sphere. And we got to use a lot of standard video game tricks like, you know, distant cards to make the environment look bigger and stuff like that. But it actually plays into the narrative because, like, that's what this species did. And so it's sort of like us poking fun at, like, ourselves for making, like, this weird game. And, you know, then we made a normal game inside of the weird game.
And not even this alien species wanted to simulate a spherical
exactly.
world. But the Outer Wilds did.
Don't do it.
Don't do it. So yeah, that's sort of like the basic idea for the art direction. And we're going to go into some specifics about, essentially like the river, which is like the big VFX thing and the thing that changes over time. And then we're also going to talk about the dream world and some of the stuff that we did there. So I think John, you were going to activate.
Let me hit the button. Okay, so here we are in the ring world, as we call it internally, inside the Stranger. And one of the big events in the time loop, actually, you know what? I should just do it instead of talking about it. You guys can see what this is.
You really have a button for it?
We sure do.
Oh. Wow. The power you have.
Yeah.
So one of the things we did with this is we wanted to make sure that as the wave passed through the entire ring, it felt like it was, you know, physically destroying the environment. So I'll talk about that a little later. But as you can see, there are particle effects that play when it hits certain buildings. We have animation curves for them falling over. And, you know, we have some physics objects that get detached. And I'll just speed up time so you can see the rest. Another little thing we have actually. Yeah, so there it goes. That's the flood. So back in the editor, let me talk about the shader going on here. Okay, so the Ringworld River is one of the most complex shaders in the entire game. Surprise, surprise, it uses a version of the tessellated sphere renderer, except this is a tessellated ring renderer. Ooh. So it has the same sort of thing where if you're close to it, the geometry is more dense. If you're far away from it, the geometry is sparse, which is really useful when you can, you know, see up to the other side of the river all the time. And, you know, it was important that we did this because really early on, like Wesley said, we decided that we wanted there to be a whole river you can raft through. So, you know, it's a natural fit that we, you know, retrofitted some of our technology for this. Anyway, the shader is really complex, and I believe it has 14 different textures. And the reason we use so many is that we have a bunch of elongated textures that determine the visuals of the river at different points along the ring. So they basically they start here and they're mapped all the way around and end at the dam again. You can see some of them over here. Basically, we have a bunch of data packed into different channels for these elongated textures to determine the visuals, like, oh, where should the foam show up? You know, what way should the current flow visually? Or, you know, what should the particulate color of the different areas be like? You can see in here, it's a little bit greener than over here where it's bluer in the reservoir. And so, you know, for example, we have a bunch of different maps for that. And the reason that we have two of them is because the river changes in the pre and post flood states. So do a cool thing here. We can do the flood lerp, which, you know, side effect of it is that you can see the flood going along in the editor. But what this does is this is how it chooses what point along these textures to blend. So it lerps between them. You know, if the wave is here, it uses this area would be the post-flood, and all the rest of the ring would be the pre-flood until it goes all the way around, and then, you know, everything is using the post-flood textures. Yeah, so that's pretty technical, but I thought it was cool. Another thing going on is we have the flow maps for like the direction that the waves scroll, and these are baked from the physical currents that the designer set up. So it should, you know, it feels correct without us having to, like, you know, try to do some like weird UV trickery or something. Yeah. And then, like Wesley explained with the ocean and Giant's Deep, we have four textures, which in themselves have four monochrome textures that determine the way that the waves look. So we have basically the chop one, we repurposed that slot for the rapids. And then we have like a macro, main, and micro waves slot. And the texture basically cycles between using the red channel, all these, the green, and then the blue and the alpha, and so on. So you can see the waves changing over time. And it's, you know, it feels more organic and physical than if there was just, you know, the same texture panning along the whole thing. Another cool thing that we do with these is they have different weights based on the flow speed, I believe. So in here, you'll see the waves are more spread out. But if you go to the reservoir, pre-flood, you can see that the waves are a lot more linear and calm, and that's because the flow speed in here is different. So the, you know, like the look of the river changes as you go along the ring, which is neat.
Is there a way to visualize the flow, especially around the part where it splits into the canyon?
I think so. When I turn gizmos on, you can see the currents. I think if I select one of these, is this what you mean?
Yeah,
kind of like that. Yeah. So these are the currents that the designer set up. And you know, they're very specific to make sure you don't get stuck in places, or, you know, you see like, you know, a hint of a certain building depending on where you're going.
So what is the blue and the red telling us? There's some blue, some red.
I know the blue is currents. The red.
So they're both currents.
Pre and post flood?
Yeah, it's pre and post flood.
Yeah. Okay. Oh yeah. Cool. Yeah, you can see by the height. These are lower. These are higher. Yeah. So that's why we have two sets.
Right.
Something cool that I want to show, because Halloween was just recently, and I think Twitch chat will enjoy this, is I can turn the river to a river of blood.
Oh.
And we're just gonna do it real quick.
Find change the
particulate
color.
Density. So we have the opacity. Here it is. Change it to 1 because it should be opaque, and then we'll change this. That. Okay, just real quick for everybody. Get your clips ready.
Oh my god.
Turn on lighting. I'm gonna spawn in the docking bay, but I'll just walk out.
So spooky.
Very spooky.
Yeah, we joked about at one point, you know, for Halloween having like a toggleable thing for you know, the water to be blood red and to have the lighting be lower, but you know, too much work, we're busy trying to put patches out.
But
it would have been cool.
That would have been cool. Maybe next Halloween.
Yeah, maybe crack open the project and get that going. Okay, let's go.
Oh, wow.
Oh my god,
that is so cool.
And I think we can make, I have my infinite jetpack here. Fun fact, we didn't have that through development of the base game. We added that a little bit later, but it's very useful. See the flood go through, just for fun.
Yeah.
And I'll land somewhere and fast forward through it, and then we will move on. So there you go, everybody. There is the Blood River.
There it is.
Thank you for showing us that. That's awesome.
Yeah. Twitch exclusive.
Twitch, yep. Yeah, seriously. Watch that get clipped into like a million YouTube videos now.
Last thing I want to show is I want to talk a little bit about the destruction in the ring world, because there's some fun tidbits. So over in the Cinder Isles, Wesley set up these animation curves when the flood hits the buildings. So basically they have like a very bespoke, specific way that they're supposed to shift when the water hits them, because it's important for level design. But so we do that with some assets, but in the let's go here. In the Hidden Gorge, we have a lot of bridges break off. And those are physically simulated as they go down the current. But a fun little tidbit about that is there's a shot in our reveal trailer where this bridge breaks, and the camera is just wide enough to be able to see the sides of this building. And we didn't want players who watched the trailer to realize that the DLC was set on, you know, an inverse curvature ring. We wanted people to think that it was just like a normal planet because it's a cool reveal. So we actually lied in our trailer a little bit, and we tilted this building. We fixed the bridge too, and we tilted this the opposite direction. And right. You can go back in the trailer and check this so that, you know, no super sleuths would go back through the trailer and realize like, hey, something's up.
You know your community very well. You know they're going to pick up on these tiny details.
Yeah. So yeah, I mean, wouldn't you know, you make a game about hiding mysteries under people's noses and you get a community full of detectives.
Yeah.
Go figure.
We found it very thematically appropriate that we were doctoring footage to hide the truth for our trailer.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, right. Okay. Another spoiler warning there.
Yeah.
Yep. Amazing. Yeah, so that's it for the river, I think. We're going to move on to Wesley for occlusion volumes, right?
Yeah, switch over to my screen.
Oh, and just before that, I want to talk about, like, for the destruction, I remember you mentioned that, like, you know, some buildings have different states, right?
But
that you did some things with, like, just regular animation, but then also some things were more physically based, right? When the flood.
Yeah. So yeah. A lot of the bridges will detach and then be physically simulated as they're carried along the river. Mm-hmm. So there's like an intact mesh, and then it gets switched out for like two broken ends and the bit that floats that comes off.
Okay.
And another thing we do, like if this roof gets destroyed, for example, we have like a destructibles group and then a destroyed remains group. And the destructibles get turned off and swapped with this. At the same time that we play a bunch of splash and splinter particle effects to hide it.
Nice. And so like, you are literally just like swapping from one mesh to the other, but you're covering it up with.
Yeah, in these cases.
Yep. Yeah. Okay. Cool. And we're going to talk more about that, more about swapping props a little later, right?
Yeah. So the next thing I want to talk about is occlusion volumes. As we mentioned, we knew very early on that we wanted this to be more like spookier on the side of the spectrum of scary things. And something that we did a lot in the base game is, you know, when you enter a cave, we sort of surreptitiously like turn down the ambient light so that it goes to pitch black. But because the ring world is populated by all these tiny little buildings, it felt very strange to like walk in here and, you know, the ambient light's down. So you turn around and like the world is dark. It was really just like kind of immersion breaking. So what we did is we created a new solution, which we call occlusion volumes, which is basically just an arbitrary volume. We can make meshes of any type. And in that area, all mesh renderers have their occlusion set to a value. So in most places it's one, but we can also make like, you know, less opaque numbers. So basically that allows us to have this where, you know, from the outside you have this dark spooky interior, and then meanwhile while you're in here you can still see the light outside. This may not seem that special because a lot of like AAA games have baked lighting where, you know, they do these like fancy you know textures that have all the shadow information, so you get this sort of stuff. But because Outer Wilds is the game you shouldn't try to make, everything is moving all the time, we have no static objects, and we can't bake lighting. So we created the solution to sort of, again, like catch up to like normal video game stuff in our own special way. Another cool part about this that makes it feel a lot more natural is we have occlusion lights, which are basically the negative space for an occlusion volume. Mm-hmm. So you can see here the ambient light is like spilling through the building. That's basically like a light that we create, and we put a cookie on it and it reveals only ambient light. So you can see my flashlight still overwrites it like any direct light would.
Nice.
But when it's just ambient, it has this nice fall off and it fades over distance. Yes, exactly. Right. And we can make those arbitrary shapes. So in some places we have it like going through holes in the wall or something like that. And we just bake those out individually. So I can show another example of this over here. So this building has an occlusion volume that's not set to one. So you can see there's still a little bit of light spilling through here. And then the lower layer has a different occlusion volume where it like blends up through the stairwell, so you can see some of the light spilling through from below.
Yeah.
So we use these all over the place, basically everywhere where we could. We have these, so there's like one in the cave down here to make it darker from a distance. It's just, you know, really helps to sell like the horror vibe of like, you see this spooky shack and you're like, what's inside? I can't see. I don't want to go in there.
And so this is not to be confused with like a fog measure, like a, or anything like that, right? You're speaking to the AO values, right?
Correct. Yeah. So if I go in the scene here, we can take a look at it. So I think I'm looking at this building. So you can see in the hierarchy here, we just have occlusion effects. If I open that up, so you can see there's an occlusion volume that's just the shape of this building. I'll make it bigger so you can see a little more clearly. This one is separate for the entryway. We did that so that there's like some light spilling in the entryway here, and it's like at a half value, and then the deeper parts of the building go to like pitch black. Turn off my gizmos so it's a little more clear. And you know, we have the occlusion light, so like the bright light from the outside spills into the doorway, and then the dim light from here spills into the pitch black area, so it helps to mask that transition. So yeah, these are just, they're just meshes, you know, super simple, but they just basically turn the AO on for those objects. And that sort of stacks with like screen space AO and stuff like that as well. So the light, you can see the one that's in the door. If I just like move this around, you can see it's just like a cutout that basically affects that, and we can change the opacity there. And it just has a cookie that we baked from the shape of the door. So it's a system that's just like really robust, and I was super happy to have it because I always wanted to do stuff like this in the base game. So we made a lot of use for it in the DLC. Yeah. And it's also used in the dream world. So I'll go ahead and segue over to that and just show how we use it there too.
While we're loading, something that I saw asked on Reddit and Twitter about the dream world, and I don't know if we have an easy way to do this, but some people were curious if we could like show a light version of it. I don't know if the lighting setup is able to do that, but in case you know, Wesley.
Yeah, I can sort of give the tutorial on that.
And for anyone wondering, you get to the dream world by literally like falling asleep in the game, and then you wake up and you find yourself in a different world.
Yeah. All right, so go ahead and click play so we can spawn in here. This is one of those effects that like happens at runtime, so it's, you can't really see it in the editor unless you're playing the game in play mode. I think there's a way to set it up with like a second camera and post-processing settings, but I always just do this because it's faster.
And one thing I love is that when making this DLC, you didn't like try to come up with too many new, like you didn't come up with too many new player mechanics, right? So like, the falling asleep was a feature that already existed in the game. You just found a new way to utilize it.
Exactly.
To extend its use. Because I feel like if you were to add a new mechanic, then it would become obvious that it's part of the puzzle. Whereas it's kind of blended in. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, so here's the dream world. This, by design, needed to be pitch dark in most places. Because, you know, it's where the horror sequences happen, and it's also, you know, basically this whole artifact is designed to like hide things in the dark, which is, you know, the whole theme of the DLC. And so if I pause it in play mode, we can take a look. This is a similar setup, but it's sort of a combination of different things from the rest of the game. If I go into the scene here, I'll turn off wireframe. So you can see there is some ambient light spilling through in some places, like on the river and like on the tops of the trees. And that's because we use a projected ambient light, which is under here. So we basically, because it's not on a sphere anymore, we instead have a height map ambient light baker, which basically you can just create an arbitrary volume and it projects a height map, and you can, you know, it turns into a texture, so you can just hand paint it after that, which I did for all of them. And then that basically modulates the ambient light. We also have normal ambient light controls, so we can change the intensity or the fall off. And the fall off is like based on distance. And the reason we did it that way, as well as having the texture in there, is because we wanted to make sure that, you know, if you're a player and you turn your gamma all the way up, you can't break the horror sequences. So they're still pitch black, no matter how high you turn your gamma.
Nice. But you did give the nice option of turning off the harm mode for people who were, you know, couldn't handle it, maybe.
Yeah, we definitely have some stuff in there to help with that, but,
yeah.
You know, regardless of how spooky it is, it needs to be dark for, like,
yes.
gameplay reasons. And so, yeah, we made sure that the fall-off doesn't hit the ground, and the map modulates it so that, you know, you still have these pools of shadow. So if I turn up the fall-off, you can see what it would look like if, you know, their home world was bright and cheery like Timberhearth. So yeah, it's a, in some places in the dream world, we use those same occlusion volumes, specifically like inside of buildings. I think there's cabins over there. Yeah. So like, you know, those types of things still have occlusion volumes to then further mask the ambient light to make sure none of it gets through. But yeah, out here in the woods, it's entirely controlled by that fall off and the texture.
So is this it with all the lights on, or is there a way to have it even, like, brighter?
I mean, I could just, like, turn off lighting in the scene view. You. So, you know,
there you go.
That's what it looks like without the,
yeah,
with just the ambient light.
Mm-hmm.
If I turn that back to the default settings. Yeah, so we did, like I said, part of the theme is that, you know, this is a fictional world, and John's going to talk more about this, but we have these, you know, fake backdrops so that when you're going through the woods, it feels like you're in this massive environment.
Yeah, I'll show this real quick at the start before I go into the renovator.
Yeah, so I think it's a good time to switch over to John.
Yeah, so we'll switch over to John's screen to talk about the prefab workflow for this.
Yeah, so just since Wesley mentioned it, I'll go over these real quick. One of the benefits about working on somewhere that's flat where you can't go to anywhere you can see, we can use fake cards. So we have these black background cards for trees in the Shrouded Woodlands, I think is what it's called. And we have just a tiny little atlas. You can only see it here because the textures and the transparency of four different trees. And so, yeah, this is like one of the few spots where we can use like a little bit of fakery to imply, you know, space beyond what you can see in gameplay. We kind of do another thing like that here, too, where there's like a fake perspective foreshortening and like diminishing of the cliffs in the Endless Canyon.
Mm-hmm.
So, to move on to our prefab replacement tool here, one of the things that was important about working on Echoes of the Eye is we kind of have these like layers of hidden worlds, sort of. So, what that meant is that when we were making the architecture kit in particular, but also trees and things, we needed different versions of different assets. And where this really came into play was in The Stranger. The slide reels that you see, they were made long, long ago in the past when the ring world was really nice and intact. So for the slide reels, we had to make a tool where we would replace all the like rotten or, you know, dead tree assets with like lifelike versions of them, which in this case, you know, would be the ones that we use in the dream world. So we had this tool called the Ring World Prefab Renovator. The R is capitalized, so it could be the RRR, the R in prefab. And so, yeah, this was originally designed for slide reels, but something that ended up being really useful about it was we developed the like intact material versions that we use in of the architecture kit that we use in the dream world after we made the base version of it. So a lot of these levels were built with essentially the ring world kit, and we needed a good way to replace them. So it turned out that we could use this tool that was made for the slide reels on something else. What it does is it has a huge list of paired prefabs, and we create these lists, we can save them, we can load different ones. And we use them to quickly replace sets of prefabs with other sets of prefabs. So I can drag in the root that I want it to affect, and I'll do this in reverse first. Some of the roofs don't get swapped out because these are specifically roofs without colliders, so they don't have an equivalent. But so, you know, here it looks like it's the ring world architecture. And then really quickly, we can just do this and it replaces it with all the Dreamworld intact versions, which saved us so much time, especially for things like props, which, you know, might not be on the grid. You can't just approximate it. So it really helps to have this tool that like pairs all the prefabs. It, you know, keeps the transforms, and it just replaces them cleanly. And, you know, for the most part, you can undo it by doing the reverse option. But the other place that this ended up being really useful, and again, you know, spoiler warning if you're not done with the DLC, we have another layer to the dream world, which we'll call the simulation view. And how this works is, you know, there are some cases, I won't go into detail about it, where you basically see the functional version of the simulation with like rendering off. So, you know, this is what it actually looks like without all the, you know, the lighting and, you know, the way that things are supposed to look. This is like the bones and the functional parts of the simulation. And what we had to do for this was create a bunch of different assets because we didn't want it to look like it was just a retextured version of the dream world. So we have a whole new set of architecture kit, different trees. We built all these separately, but again, they have to go in the exact same place as the existing architecture. And it would take so long and it'd be a huge pain and honestly not really feasible with a small team to just hand place all these again. So what we did was we would duplicate our, we duplicate the existing level geometry, and then we have a simulation prefab mapping that replaces all of those prefabs. Yeah, I can do it here, but it might not show up because of the layer. One second, replace with first, turn on the layer.
Anyway, this allowed you to not have to like just build this world twice, right?
Yes, exactly. You know, there was a possibility we could have had to build it like three times.
Yeah.
You know, with like the early level geometry and later. So it was a really huge time saver to have this tool.
Again, which goes back to the philosophy of like build tools first, then start building the game. Otherwise this would have been like maybe taken two times as long or something. Yeah.
Exactly. At least.
At least, yeah.
So the next thing I'll talk about is the shader.
Yeah.
And so something that I was really excited about, this was one of my biggest responsibilities on DLC. And I love when games kind of like bend your perception of reality. So this was kind of like a dream project to work on to do this thing. And so I had an exciting time working on this shader with Logan that does a lot of the like visual work that maybe we'd have to do with like manual texturing and UVs for us. Because again, we're making the whole world again. We don't want to have to UV everything and we want it to look consistent because we're a small team. So one of the biggest things that the shader does is all the UVs on these assets are projected in world space. And I'll show you, if I do this and I tilt it, you'll see when it favors something that's not the y-axis, okay. It uses the like scrolling wall texture. And so what that means is, you know, the walls, they have these like scrolling diamonds to represent like a flow of data, but the floor doesn't have that. So, you know, it's a little bit easier to tell the walls from the floor. Because another issue that we had with this early on was navigation. We didn't want this to be too expensive to render, and we wanted to highlight the idea that it, you know, it was the world without all the like visual frills. It was just, you know, what it looks like stripped down. So there's no lighting, and that can make it really hard to navigate.
Yeah.
So we hooked in the depth color from, or well, we hooked in depth from the camera, and we multiplied that from with a depth color to shader. So actually, I'll show it in the trees because that will show it off a little better here over here. Yeah. So if we look from over here, and we turn down this value, it's a lot harder to see what's close to you and what's far. It, without lighting, it's just really hard to navigate. So one of the most helpful things we did with this was use camera depth to multiply this value. Suddenly, what's close to you is bright and what's far away from you is dark. So that's one of the biggest things we did for this. It has a bunch of scrolling textures that combine to create this kind of look.
Yeah, that works really well. But there's also another aspect to it where I noticed like some objects, like some props, and like the columns are like brighter and they're more highlighted. What's the logic behind that?
Yes, thank you for asking. So the way those work is, again, we didn't want to do manual UVs. So these use vertex color. And I think I can show it if I do this. Yeah. The trees have their own vertex color. But basically, we use the red channel in the vertex color of all the simulation view assets to determine the strength of the glow. And I can show that right here. There's a specific material with vertex paint on it. This one. Vertex rating. Yeah. So these are all, the brightness is controlled by the red channel of vertex color. So this helps certain things pop out.
And this is more manual.
Yeah. It's
painting the environment.
Yeah, but we paint it we don't do it after the level is built. We do it per asset. So like, for example, all the floors have like this rim along them and, you know, these railings are all glowy. But yeah, that was another tricky way that we used to avoid having to do these. Something we didn't talk about early on, which maybe you can talk about it later if you want, Wesley, is we use vertex color a lot in Outer Wilds to determine like material blends and things, because we try to avoid making unique textures when we can. So a lot of things are really big or, you know, we have performance constraints based on memory. The last thing I want to talk about with this shader is that we have a separate one for the interactables where they glow white. So they're bright and you can see them from far away in the environment.
Yeah.
Originally, when we designed these, we wanted to have them red because it would stand out. But we realized that if people were colorblind, you know, that wouldn't really work. It might blend into the environment and then the design kind of fails. So instead, we tried having them be white because values can always stand out. And I feel like this worked out really well because it feels like more cold and technical. And it gives it, you know, more of a unified palette than if there were like a bunch of different glowy colors.
We have a great question in the chat by a friend. What is the name? France Jirachi. Can we have a blood dream world?
I don't know.
Look at what you've done.
Yeah, what have I done? Yeah, unfortunately, there are a lot of values on this that do the colors, so I couldn't turn it red. But yeah, that would be fun. We did play with a lot of different colors of this when we were developing it.
Yeah.
We settled on this like matrix green.
Kind of thing. Yeah, I was going to say, is it slightly matrix inspired? Like, is it just something we're kind of used to?
Unintentionally, we were like, oh, damn, with this, like, you know, flowing data, we accidentally made the matrix. You know, I'd have to pick Logan's brain to figure out how intentional or not that was for, you know, the way this stuff moves. But yeah, it's...
We were definitely aware of the parallels to matrix. The reasoning why we did it the way we did is because, you know, we wanted the world to feel dreamlike, and having these sort of like, you know, almost like slow motion rain felt very dreamlike, and it just so happened to be the same thing that the matrix did. So, you know, maybe it was a similar series of decisions that led to that. The green color actually comes from old concept art for the Nomai. When we were doing the art reboot, the Nomai color was green instead of blue, and it always just sort of felt wrong. We were just like, this isn't quite the right color. Like, it feels too sci-fi. It's not rustic enough. And so we ended up changing them to like the ghostly blue, which feels a lot more like naturalistic. But when we came up with the idea for this species, like, their whole thing is that they're not natural. So we were like, now it's time to use that green.
Yeah, artificial is perfect.
Yeah.
Right. It's a kind of also foreshadowing.
Not a lot of people see this in game because, like, there is... Basically, the way that the simulation view works, it's kind of rare that people end up seeing this, but we did create a different shader for the burn building because it's like destroyed and not intact. That was kind of like the reverse of the regular simulation shader.
Yeah, we have a lot of questions about the... Before we move on to the next section, I definitely want to go through some of these questions. GB12 asks, hey, are the loading screens in the dream world actual loading screens, since they're pretty... Since they pretty much aren't anywhere else. Also,
yeah,
you guys
I can
are
talk
great
about that. we have these tunnels, and basically, there's a tunnel between every dream zone, and they warp you basically just a short distance, except for, you know, the fourth one, which loops around to the first. But it's not actually a loading screen. And the funny thing is, if you go into it in the simulation view, you can see what's happening. We kind of left that in because it felt thematically appropriate. But we have some darkness planes and like a mesh that wraps around the rocks, the tunnels, that fade to black and take out all the lighting. And then when you're fully faded to black, that's when we warp you, and then we slowly bring it back in. So it's like it intentionally feels a bit like a loading screen. Mm. But yeah, you're really just warping between these different spots. And feel free to add anything if you have more thoughts on that, Wesley.
Yeah, I mean, in the technical sense, we do like turn off stuff in the zones that you're not in. So it is sort of loading. But, you know, it's not loading in the sense that like it's pretending to be, I guess.
The infinite IKEA 3008 asks, was, I don't know where they come up with these names, was the BRDF used for raft propulsion lights?
Yes, so the light sensors all over the ring world, and there's a few in the dream world, use that same BRDF.
Good eye.
So yeah, it's, you know, we made use of that there. I always wanted to add in a feature where, you know, it would sort of have like a fake light inside of it, like the gravity crystals, but we didn't have time to implement that. So we just swap it out to an emissive material when you shine your light on it, which gets the idea across, but doesn't look quite as magical as I always wanted it to. Okay.
And then we have another question. Where is the dream world physically located? In the infinite space, question mark? Like, can we reach it with our spaceship?
The dream world is actually like a separate plane of existence, so to speak. It doesn't live in the solar system like Dark Brindle does. as far as I know. I could be wrong, but yeah. Pretty sure it's just separate.
And then the infinite IKEA asks again, how many times did you get jump scared by your own creations as you were testing the game?
I had some scary moments with my testing for sure. Even it's like, I don't know, testing the achievements, like once I'd been playing it for a while and it was almost out, like I had some spooky moments. These guys are scary.
Yeah. Did you turn off the spooky mode?
The main time I would get jump scared is when I'm like testing something else. So it's like, okay, I need to like go make sure like this part of the level design is fine. I'm like looking at it, and then like, you know, one just walks up behind me and it's like, yeah, I should have seen that coming.
Yeah. And then I really like this question. Space Lover asks, how did you make the dream world tilt when the tower tilts? Did you just adjust gravity of the player? And then another user chimed in and said, I'm also curious about that because it once happened and I got thrown out of the tower when it happened. And
do you know, Wesley?
Such a cool moment.
I'm pretty sure it is just gravity, because the idea is that, like, you know, whatever happens to your body in the ring world is still happening to you because you're just asleep. And so, you know, it's a bit of that like Inception style stuff. And there's a few things like that across the dream world that can happen. But I'm pretty sure it does just like change your gravity angle.
Is this kind of a similar situation to when you have a ship on another planet where you have to keep rendering the physics of the ship? Do you have to keep rendering the physics of the player in the tower as you're sleeping while you're in the dream world?
It's a bit more forgiving. We did some stuff to like unload things a bit more than we do in the rest of the game. But we definitely, the river and all the time changeover time systems do communicate with you while you're in the dream world. But thankfully, we can sort of, you know, turn off a lot of the rest of the solar system or put it down to like bare bones mode while you're in there. That's part of why we did the dream world the way that we did, is because like, A, it's thematically appropriate, and B, it also lets us get away with a lot of stuff that we couldn't in the rest of Outer Wilds.
How did it feel like finally like getting a taste of normal game development working
felt like cheating. I remember Alex saying that.
Yeah, a lot of our level design and like environment artists were just like, yeah, this just feels like it's easy mode.
This feels wrong.
It's like easy to see things with your camera, you know, you don't have to twist around.
It's easy to import and export from Maya without like pivots break.
Mm. Okay. Yeah. Got it. Okay. And so I think I think we're gonna go to the end in a quite a poetic way, you know. It will end it with the sun and wrap up with describing the supernova, you know, as all things end with a giant massive supernova that ends the universe. So yeah, we'll swap to Wesley's screen and we'll talk about, I guess, the stars, the sun, and then the supernova. So we'll start with the stars.
All right.
Yeah.
So the first thing I wanted to show about the stars is that, once we switch over.
There we go.
So the stars, I'm in play mode, so you can see, they're actually just this tiny little sphere. they draw behind everything else, and they're anchored to the player, so they move with you, so there's no parallax or anything. But they're actually really small. So, you know, the whole star field is just this little bubble around you as you go. But I wanted to show the stars because, you know, in a lot of games you have like a skybox and it's like this painted texture or whatever. We actually modeled them out. We have a tool that we use to generate these, where we have control over like the density of the stars, the color, like range, in terms of a gradient, the randomization of like scale of each star. But the tool also gives us the ability to set how many stars survive to the end of the loop versus how many stars supernova. And so, you know, each one of these little meshes will either fade out or play a little animation where it essentially shrinks and then expands and then fires off a little particle system to match the supernova. So, you know, we wanted to really communicate to the player like, hey, this isn't just your star, like this is the end of the universe. Everything is dying. And so that's why we have these meshes. And we also, you know, a big part of the art direction, as I said, was like NASA inspired. So we wanted this to feel more like photos you'd see from NASA instead of like, you know, cool sci-fi star field with all these crazy colors. So we intentionally did more like muted natural colors to make it feel like, you know, you're out in the dark, unforgiving space. And fun fact, we have a separate star field for the dream world that has like more stars and they're brighter because we wanted it to feel like an earlier place and time in the universe. And none of them go supernova. So, you know, if you're in the dream world at the end, there's still a nice starry sky. And then you go back to the real world and there's no stars left.
I love that attention to detail. Like when I saw this, I was just, or when I heard about this, I was just blown away that like you're among the stars the entire time. Like all the stars you see out in the distance are actually right in front of your face. They're just really small. And I guess they're rendered behind any object that's in front of you.
Exactly.
So it feels like they're in the
distance. I was looking to see if I could find one of the supernovas, but if I do fast forward, we might be able to see. But maybe we'll see one as I talk about the sun. So the sun, as you might expect, it uses our tessellated sphere renderer. So another, another good use of that.
Yeah.
So I'll just go over to the sun. So you can see, you know, the same setup as Giant's Deep. It's undulating and moving around, and that's based on a very similar shader. This one is emissive. So, you know, it's slightly different in that regard, but it uses still the four channel height map, similar wave settings. We spawn like some sunspots occasionally and like, you know, solar flares and stuff that are just like these little meshes that scale up and disappear. But yeah, it's pretty much just a tessellated sphere. The main thing about the sun is that it has this color ramp. And we have, this is basically color over time. So as the sun expands in size, it also progresses through this color ramp and it's a height map. So, you know, the lower parts in the sun are this brighter color and the peaks of the little like plasma mountains are the darker color. And so you get that feeling of like a, you know, a solar photo from NASA. And then over time, you know, it gets much darker and redder at the core. And so we have a nifty little fast forward button so I can just sort of show that play out in real time. Let me move my buckle up prompt there. So it looks like I'm getting closer to the sun, but it's actually the sun getting bigger. Actually, this hotkey's not working. Interesting. Well, hopefully the other hotkey works, which is the supernova button, which is the end key. So I'll quickly explain it before it happens.
Is it really?
Yeah, it's the end key on the keyboard.
That's amazing.
So basically, once the sun has reached its maximum size, we switch it out, the color ramp. And so we have multiple different materials here. So there's collapse start and collapse end, and basically these have different wave settings and, you know, color ramp progression. And so we essentially blend from one ramp to the other. And then, you know, once it's actually supernovaing, it switches to that blue color, which is on this other color ramp. So we'll just watch it in action and end our chat with the same way we do everything else with the supernova. So you can see it's that same waves. It's literally just the sun surface is scaling. And then we fire off some particles and some meshes to make that initial shockwave. And then it's literally just our tessellated sphere renderer again, just getting bigger and bigger. And as the surface of the supernova gets closer to you, we play a little particle effect so that if you're not looking at it, you have some clue as to what's happening.
Something else cool we do is we dim the ambient lights on every planet when this goes off, right?
Yeah, exactly. So the ambient lights on each planet communicate with the sun. So when the supernova, like when the sun collapses, we turn off all the ambient lights, so you're pitch black no matter where you are. And then when the sun explodes, we turn on a really bright blue version of the sunlight. So basically it further communicates what's happening. And then in addition to that, you get some cool effects like on Giant's Deep, you know, the supernova tints all the clouds and everything differently because they transmit light. So that's our final VFX thing of the day.
That's amazing. Okay, this is quite the journey from Timber Hearth to the supernova. Thank you so much for sharing all of that with us. I'm wondering, you know, this was a really long journey for you, Wesley. Also a long journey for you, John. I'm wondering if you have any final takeaways for us, lessons learned along the way that you can share with our community.
Yeah, I think, you know, our biggest lesson, which we sort of talked about throughout, is make tools. Outer Wilds would not have been possible without the tools that we made. And as I mentioned in our first, you know, quicker iteration on the production schedule, we didn't have a lot of the tools that made the game possible. And, you know, we were still scraping by. We, you know, put ferns all over the place and it took weeks and weeks and weeks. But it really was like pulling teeth and, you know, it was hard to make the art polished because we just didn't have enough time. And once we had the proper tools, that really gave our art team the leverage we needed to polish the game and really allowed us to do a lot of the crazy things that we did. So, you know, whatever game you're making, figure out like what it is and make the tools that will make it faster to develop, because that'll save you. It seems like a waste of time at the beginning because you're like, oh, we're spending weeks and weeks writing this tool, but then it saves you months down the line.
Yeah.
So that's definitely
a piece of
advice. Mm-hmm. And then sort of the last bit that I would mention is, you know, I sort of said this in the art direction talk at the beginning, but we've really tailored the Outer Wilds art team to support. You know, there's a lot of room for ego in game development, and you have all these ideas that you want to see in the game. And, you know, most of us become game developers because it's like, oh, I want to see my ideas in the game. But really the core of video games is the design. Like, the game needs to be fun. It needs to be able to do the things that it is trying to do. Mm-hmm. And we've really like built our art team to support the game designers. So, you know, we try and leave our ego at the door, and, you know, it's not always easy and we make mistakes along the way, but it's really, you know, beneficial in the long run to trust your designers and support them in whatever way you can, because that's how you get really interesting and compelling ideas. And I think I forgot to mention this at the beginning, but the founder of our company was Masioka, who's an actor, and he would run improv sessions with us. And so just sort of like as a team building exercise, you know, we'd get together in the office and do improv. And so we really take that same approach to game development of yes and. And so, you know, we have our designers generate these concepts and then they bring them to the art team and the programmers, and everyone is allowed to sort of contribute and build off of the ideas. And, you know, not all of that makes it into the final project because, you know, you can't put everything in a game. You have to cut plenty of stuff, and it might not seem like we cut a lot of stuff because Outer Wilds is full of details, but we really did. And so, you know, it's a lot about just collaborating with each other and, you know, letting the game be itself, not trying to fight that.
It's a little bit cliche, but I think it's very relevant to Outer Wilds. What I want to say is I think it's really important to be curious and ask questions. Yeah. And the reason I say that is because when I was hired, and I'd already played Outer Wilds, one of the first things I did after I got off work and I had like Unity access was I just wanted to look at all the scenes, see how things were built. You know, I wanted to see Giant's Deep in scene. I wanted to look at, you know, the tornadoes. I wanted to see how the geode material worked in Brittle Hollow. And I think that made a really big difference for me, like learning more about our pipeline and stuff. And I think it's part of the reason that I'm here, you know, talking about this stuff today, because I was just really excited about it. And I asked Wesley a bunch of questions and he was, you know, very kind to explain all these things that were before my time when I got here. And it helped a lot. And I think that's relevant to, you know, any kind of game development, whether you're a professional or not.
Definitely.
Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you again, John and Wesley. This was a pleasure.
Yeah, thanks so much.
Yes. Yeah, thank you.
And we'll see you later. Bye, everyone.